everyone. This is Robert Wenzel. Welcome to a special edition of the Robert Wenzel Show. You didn't hear the usual music introduction because what we're doing is we're putting the raw audio tape up of the debate I'm having here with Stefan Kinsella. So this will be on my site, economicpolicyjournal.com, and it will also be at Stefan's site as part of his podcast. I don't know how Stefan has what his link is, so I'll have him mention that when he gets on the show, which is right now, Stefan. So take it away. You have 8 minutes.
Thanks, Bob. I'll try to use less than that. Long time no see, and I don't really know if this is going to be a debate or a discussion or an interrogation, because I don't really know if you have a whole position on IP. So I'll wait for your statement to see. Been waiting for a few years to see what you could come up with. Let me just lay out a few things that I think ought to be fairly uncontroversial, and I won't ask you to positively agree to every one of them because that's going to be tedious. But what I would say is, you know, I would ask you to specifically tell me which ones you disagree with when it's your turn or later in our discussion. Otherwise, I'm going to have to assume that they're pretty reasonable assumptions. Number one, you and I are both Austrian libertarians, and I'm an anarchist. I'm assuming you're something of the same. And a discussion about legal policy and rights and property rights among fellow libertarians and Austrians is going to be different than one between, say, me and the mainstreamer. I might have to see my whole position against intellectual property is based upon my understanding of Austrian and libertarian property rights. But if I'm talking to a mainstreamer, utilitarian, a Kosian, a leftist, they don't necessarily agree with property rights, at least the same way as I do. So I can't even say that the problem with IP is that it violates property rights because they don't even necessarily agree with property rights, at least the way I understand it. I'm going to assume you and I both agree and that it's uncontroversial that there ought to be a free market and a system of private property rights in scarce resources. I'm hoping that you and I can both agree on that, and I don't care what your basis is or what others' basis is. I don't care if it's utilitarian, consequentialist, pragmatic, intuitionist, deontological, or whatever. The basics of libertarian philosophy and the free market philosophy is that there ought to be private property rights in scarce resources. Okay? So if we can agree on that, then all I need to show is that this idea of intellectual property rights sets up some kind of right that is incompatible with what you and I already agree with. Okay? I don't need to have an entire theory of property rights. All I need to do is point out that these other rights are incompatible with private property rights that you and I both already agree with. So then what I would say is this. I admit that among all the people arguing about this issue, especially in the classical liberal and libertarian framework in Austrian, I do myself personally happen to know a lot about the law because I'm a practicing patent attorney for the last 20 plus years. But I don't think we need to go into the details of it. However, I do believe that someone like you, to establish the case for IP, which is your task here, I believe, you can't just pick apart things in my argument. You have to have a positive case of property. You need to have a clear and coherent definition of what you mean by intellectual property and why you think it's justified and why you think it is compatible with regular property rights. It will not do to find little niggling things that are misstatements and people's criticisms of IP. Even if I'm wrong in all of my criticisms of IP, it doesn't mean IP is justified. So what we agree on as private property supporters is we agree on the need for private property rules in scarce resources. That's what we agree on. What we don't agree on is whether you can extend a similar type of right to intellectual things, particularly patent and copyright. So what I would ask you to do is to do a couple of things. Number one, confirm that I'm correct, that we both agree on private property rights and scarce resources. And then also I would like you to tell me what your general theory of property is that would extend to IP, how it differs from regular IP, that is patent and copyright, trademark, trade secret law, and current laws, what types of IP would it protect that the current law doesn't protect? Would you protect reputations? Would you, which Rothbard disagreed with, by the way? Would you protect databases? Would you protect fashion rights, which are not really protected by IP right now? Would you make it international, or would it be national? So I want to know what exactly you favor. And then if you're not able to do that, at least give me one very simple, clear example, just one clear case, the cleanest, most direct case you can think of that shows an obvious case for intellectual property of some type in a free market that doesn't depend upon the state. Just give me one example and explain how it's compatible with private property rights. Now, my view is that the problem with intellectual property is that it is incompatible with private property rights. It's incompatible with capitalism. So it will not do for the opponents to say, well, you're a communist, you're a leftist, you're a Marxist, you don't believe in this, you don't believe in that. It won't do to mix together a utilitarian case or a consequentialist case with a principle of property rights case. You need to be clear what you're arguing for. Now, my argument is very, very simple. I would like to know if you disagree with this. I am sure, Bob, that you agree that people that have property rights and scarce resources have the right to make contracts with those resources. And I'm sure you're familiar with the restrictive covenant idea, or what's called an easement sometimes. So let's say you and I are neighbors, and let's say you and I both have homes next to each other, and neither one of us wants the other one to use our property for industrial or pig farm uses or hideous colors on our houses, because we don't want to reduce the value of our property because of an unsightly or you know, unenjoyable neighborhood. So let's say I grant you, Bob, the right to prevent me from painting my house purple, or I grant you the right to prevent me from using my property in a certain way, like for a pig farm, and you grant me a similar right. So we have these reciprocal rights established by a restrictive covenant, and basically it means you're a partial owner of my property, and I'm a partial owner of your property. I retain most of the rights of use of my property, but you have this veto right that I've granted you. Now, this is perfectly legitimate in a free society because it's a contractual arrangement between you and me. The problem with IP is that IP grants this veto right to a third party. It lets them tell me how I cannot use my own property, even though I never contractually agreed to this limitation. And even though I'm not using my property in a tortious way or in an aggressive way, like pointing a gun at someone or polluting onto their property or being a nuisance, et cetera, I'm using my property in a way that is totally private and does not invade the borders of your property. So I've not committed a tort, I've not committed a crime, and I've not agreed to a contract. And yet IP law grants this veto right, this negative servitude or negative easement, we might call it, to the third party by virtue of the state law right now. And I suppose in your system, in a private system, third parties can just assert that they have this right to control how other people use their property. Now, to my mind, that is socialist. It is anti-competitive. It's anti-free market. And it would be completely laughed out of court. And no one can get away with such an insane scheme. So I would like to see your response to that. And I would like to see from you a positive case for intellectual property that is compatible with private property rights. And I will stop here and let you go.
Okay, thanks, Stefan. The best way really to show my perspective on IP is to really discuss your book from beginning to end. I think there are so many errors in there, and that as we discuss the errors, it will become clear as to how I view IP different from you and how I would envision a free market IP world. But before we get to that, what I really want to talk about for a minute, because I've been getting some flack in the comments on my blog post, is with regard to supposed names I've been calling you and the hard time I've been giving you. But at the same time, I have not called you a clown. I have not said you were going to weasel out of anything. I never said you were going to weasel out of anything like a worm. You did all those things, Stefan. And what I want to do is I want to set the record straight exactly how this debate started and where you came in with this stuff and ask you why you did it, okay? This is what happened. On January 23rd, I wrote a column discussing some Jeff Tucker intellectual property theory. And I wrote, I continue to receive emails asking me to discuss my view on intellectual property and how it differs from the views of Stefan Kinsella and Jeffrey Tucker. As far as Kinsella is concerned, he has written a deeply thought out and complete theory of IP that I will respond to in full book length form. Kinsella's theory deserves serious treatment, and I will not attempt to address that discussion in a blog post. So I don't see anything there that would cause you to go on an attack at me. Now, from there, what happened is I actually sent, you emailed me back, or you emailed me and said, I have a new podcast. Do you want to do a joint discussion about IP? I can put it on my feed and you can on yours. So again, very polite, no problem. Then you sent, I agreed to that. I said it was a great idea. And then I sent, you sent a letter to me saying, I think, in part that said, I think we should both commit ahead of time to be respectful, sincere, civil, and give each other adequate time. No ad hominem, no personal stuff, just an Austrian libertarian-oriented focus on truth. I will not try to baffle you with legalistic bullshit just because I know IP statutes. So what happened is I actually sent that email to somebody else because there was some other information that I wanted to get out. And the person I sent that email to me said, boy, does he have the wrong impression of you. I don't recall you ever being ad hominem, personal, or disrespectful to anyone. Now, at that point, I sent an email back to this person defending you. I said, Kinsella is probably getting that from Tucker. I actually have a good relationship with Kinsella. We once sat down and we talked a lot about his background, childhood, and all. I think he's wrong about IP, but I think he is a very decent guy.
And if I bought you a drink, and I guess
right.
I guess that
exactly.
Didn't go very far.
We talked all kinds of things. And so the next thing, after defending you, the next thing I read, you're calling me a clown. You say I'm going to weasel out of the debate that I'm going to do it like a worm, and it goes on. Why did you do that, Stefan?
Well, we can talk about a few of these things if you like. It's going to eat into our time, and honestly, I'm afraid.
Well, I want to talk about it. Okay. Let me tell you something. Go ahead.
I'll talk about. You've already gone.
I still have time left, Stefan.
No, you did 3.5 minutes.
Exactly. If you know, you also put at some point you stated
when you're ready
that.
To talk, and I'll wait until you're ready.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, at some other point you stated that you did not think it was a mistake to make the debate. So my thought there is that someone told you it was a mistake because why would you said that? You invited me in the whole thing, okay? And then you start with these attacks. And so basically what you have really done is really pissed me off. So whoever told you that it was a mistake, I mean, once we go into the details, you'll see the work I've done on this. It was probably a mistake, but your second mistake was to piss me off about it. Stefan, I don't know what you're doing, but why did you call me all those names? Go ahead.
All right. So let me just say, either we're going to get to your positive presentation of intellectual property, and I don't know if we will, because honestly, Bob, I searched for 25 years for a long time before that, for a way to justify IP. Knowing Rothbardianism, knowing Ayn Rand, knowing Mises, and knowing IP very well as a practicing attorney, I searched hard for a way to justify IP for years, and I finally realized I was failing. I mean, not because I'm stupid, but because it can't be justified. I was making a fundamental mistake. I really would be amazed if you've come up with an argument I have not heard of and already refuted. I have exhaustively cataloged and refuted dozens of fallacious arguments. So I suspect you either have yet another one of those, or you just don't have an argument and you just want to nitpick on my stuff, which is fine. But the point was to try to justify AP. What I want to do is to get you to agree that the burden of proof is on you, my friend, because IP is a state-created legislated system of patent and copyright. I cannot believe that you actually defend patent and copyright. So you must have in mind something sort of similar that a private system can come up with, and that's fine. I want to hear about it. But the burden of proof, my friend, is on you to justify it, not to find nitpicks with my theory. Now, if we have time to get to that after all this background stuff, that's fine. But I'll address your answers, your questions for sure. And feel free to interrupt because we're kind of going back and forth. I just prefer to keep it free form if it's okay with you, as long as neither one of us steals the microphone. Bob, for several years you have out of the blue launched criticism, starting with Jeff Tucker and then with me, about our IP stuff. And you kept saying it's communist, it's Marxist, it's all this crap, mixing together the incentive argument with the principled argument, promising you're going to write a book on it someday. Now, this has been several years you've been doing this. So obviously you have something in your craw, and you have this innate theory, which a lot of libertarians used to or did, that IP is somehow legitimate, and people that attack it are anti-property. Now, just because the word property is used,
Stefan, your 2 minutes is up, and I just want to stop here.
Oh, you want an answer to the question about Tucker? You want an answer to the question about
The specific answer I want is why, regardless of what I said about your theories and whether it's communistic or not, by the way, in your introduction, you called something communistic. So why is it that you can call something communistic and I can't? Okay.
Well, because I have a I have a coherent definition of my term.
So do I, Stefan. Why do you think I don't? Why did you call me a worm?
Because you have promised to write this book for years now. I don't think you're going to write it. I don't think you have a coherent theory of IP. If you have it, I'd be happy to hear it.
Let me stop you there, Stefan.
You want my answer or not, Bob? Bob, let me give my answer, then you can respond. My answer is, I thought you would weasel out of the debate because you were afraid to debate me because you know you're going to lose. The entire tide is turning against IP. You know this. I know this. Almost all Austrians, all principled libertarians are against IP. And you see that this kind of weird idea you have is being completely defeated and demolished, and you're getting worried. You know you don't have a positive theory. If you did, you would have written something by now. That's what I thought. That's where I thought you'd weasel out of the debate, and you didn't, and I'm proud of you for not doing it. But it's not hostile. It's not personal. It was a prediction. It's got nothing to do with the legitimacy of IP. Whether or not I'm wrong or not about you agreeing to have a debate about IP is not a justification for IP, which is what we have to keep our focus on. Now, what other sort of side issues do you want to get out of the way? Go ahead.
Do you think I'm a worm?
No, I don't think you're a worm.
Do you think I'm a weasel?
I thought you might weasel out of the debate. Yes, I did think you might do that.
What basis?
I just told you because you had been saying you're going to write a book for a long time, and then when we agreed to a debate, you put it off 2-3 months. And
Maybe, Stefan, it's because I take my time and I am very careful before I come out with something, so I know exactly what I'm talking about. Maybe that's why
I agree. I accept your explanation. I told you already.
Okay. Am I a clown? Stefan, am I a clown?
You make some clownish arguments, yes, and you treat some of your guests in a clownish way, yes.
Give me an example.
Oh, I can't think of any offhand, but no,
so,
I don't.
All right, let's start the debate, okay? Stefan.
I'm happy to do it.
On page 18. Of your book, which, by the way, I think is terrible, misleading, poorly framed arguments, illogical at points. It's quite frankly bizarre. It's getting the attention. You write on page 18. On the other hand, there is a long tradition of opposition to patent and copyright. Modern opponents include Rothbard, McElroy, Palmer, and it goes on.
Yes.
Let me repeat. On the other hand, there is a long tradition of opposition to patent and copyright.
Yes.
Can you explain Murray Rothbard's opposition to copyright to me?
Yes. He opposed state copyright and patent law. In fact, there's an article on LouRockwell.com.
Stefan, we started this by saying you started the conversation, your opening by saying we are talking about free market in a way that we could not talk about with people that hold different views, that hold state views, and so on and so forth. Are you against IP, or are you against IP state law?
Well, intellectual property, we need to define our terms. Intellectual property is a fairly recent term that the government has come up with to group together several state laws, most
Stefan,
of them which...
Stefan, are you in favor of copyright on a free market?
Am I in favor of property right on the free market? Of course. I just said that in my opening statement.
So you're but not against intellectual property?
Yes, I'm in favor of property rights in scarce resources, which is what the libertarian tradition is all about.
Yeah, but then you're going to say that, you know, you're not in favor of copyrights the way a person would normally think about it. In other words, if I write a book and sell it to be with the determination that it shouldn't be shown to anyone else, but C gets hold of it, then you're saying all copyright bets are off. Am I correct?
I don't think that's not a precise statement for me to even respond to. First of all, you're not defining your terms. I am quite certain Rothbard was completely opposed to the Copyright Act as enacted by the federal government. And
Stefan,
Bob, you're going to have to let me answer a question, okay? This is not you interrogating me. This is an equal thing. Now, you can answer my questions. I can answer yours. Rothbard's view of copyright was a little murky. I agree. People are back and forth on this. Some people say he was totally opposed. Some people say he was partly in favor. He was against the copyright statute. He was against the patent statute. But he had this idea that you could use some kind of contractual mechanism, which he called copyright. But he used it, if you have read his Ethics of Liberty, he used it in the context of a mousetrap, which, Bob, is an invention, which is covered by patent law. So he apparently thought you could somehow put a stamp on some object that you owned that would limit the ability of the buyer to use it in certain ways. Okay, and he's correct about that. You can do that. But then to take that and say that implies there should be intellectual property or copyright is just incorrect as a factual matter. It doesn't. All that is contract law between two parties. So you have yet to define to me what you think intellectual property is or what you think is justified. So
Stefan,
you got to tell me
Stefan,
what you're defending here.
On what you write here in your book, you're not saying anything about the Copyright Act or government intervention. You're saying, on the other hand, there is a long tradition of opposition to patent and copyright.
There is.
Morning opponents include Rothbard. Do you
it
want
does.
Me to read what Rothbard said about copyright? I've got it right in front of me.
He wasn't talking about the copyright statute, Bob. I'm talking here about
That's right,
copyright.
And neither are you. You aren't talking about the copyright statute.
Bob, first of all, this is the introductory section of my essay, and what I was just trying to do is set the stage and explain there has been a lot of debate about this issue. There have been some libertarians and other free market advocates who have favored and endorsed modern patent and copyright law, and some that have generally opposed it. Now, even Mises and Hayek had statements which indicate they, especially Hayek, skepticism about it. They did not go into it into a lot of depth, and neither did Rothbard. And by the way, if you've read Rothbard's Knowledge, True and False chapter in Ethics of Liberty, you will see that he totally rejects the idea of defamation law and reputation rights, as in having a property right in something that you create because it has value. He totally rejects it. That logic would imply if he had thought about it further, he would have totally rejected. Look, he admitted patents skew research and development. He admitted the copyright statute was a legislative thing. All he said was you could have a contract and people are bound by the contract. That is all Rothbard said. That is not copyright, Bob. Everyone that knows what copyright is.
Okay, well, let me read you exactly what Rothbard said from Man, Economy, and State. Copyright, in other words, have their basis in prosecution of implicit theft. The copyright is therefore a logical device of property right on the free market. Part of the patent protection now obtained by an inventor could be achieved on the free market by a type
of
copyright protection.
Part of.
Because what it's his view of how patents should be designed. So he has no problem with copyright or patent on the free market.
That's completely false. Rothbard has a whole section debunking.
The copyright is therefore a logical device of property right on the free market. Stefan, it's as clear as day. The copyright is therefore a logical device of property on the free market.
Bob, he's giving the example of a mousetrap. Do you understand that that's an
invention? The mousetrap, don't you know the difference between copyright and patent? The mousetrap is a patent. It's not a copyright.
I know. That's why Rothbard was confused.
No, he wasn't confused. He said in the current law, copyright is with regard to a person that has independent discovery, and patent law has applies in the United States with regard to the first person that discovers it. And he said
copyright has nothing to do with independent discovery. You're wrong.
What's that?
Copyright has nothing to do with independent discovery. It has to do with original creation of an expression of some idea. That's it. Just have
to be. You know, I'll yield to you on the legal stuff. I don't know that. Non-legal way to understand it, the layman's way to
I don't want to baffle you with legal bullshit. I'm trying to explain. Look, first of all.
Yeah, but Stefan, you just said that Rothbard misunderstood copyright in implying it to a mousetrap.
No,
and a mousetrap has to do with patents.
Right. First of all,
am I right?
I want you to agree with me that it's totally irrelevant to whether IP is justified, what Rothbard thought about it. I mean, Rothbard could have been right. He could have been wrong. Even if I misdescribed his views on copyright because of his ambiguous use of the word copyright,
how is it ambiguous? What is ambiguous about the way he uses copyright? How clear could you be? Copyright is therefore a logical device of property right on the free market. Face it, Stefan, you're wrong. It's wrong in the book. You're just completely wrong about what you said. Rothbard is not against copyright in the way it stands now, and he's not against patent. He would tweak the way patent is done in a free market, but he is not against either. It's completely wrong for you to say, on the other hand, there is a long tradition of opposition to patent and copyright, including Rothbard.
First of all, you really don't think there's a long tradition of opposition to copyright and patent?
Not by Rothbard.
So what? Let's strike his name off the list. So what? What does that prove?
Okay, so the point is you're in error there.
I don't think I'm in error, but it's a side point.
Look, you're sloppy as hell in the book. Rothbard is a leading libertarian. A lot of people are going to consider his view, and people who don't have a long period of time to look up IP stuff and what Rothbard said on it, and they're going to go to your damn booklet here, and you say Rothbard is in a long tradition of opposition to copyright and patent. And
Bob, if you know me, wrong. Later on in the essay, I have a several-page section called the contractual Rothbardian reserved right or something like
that. I'm going to come back to that because you completely contradict it right here.
I deal in detail with where Rothbard is wrong and where he's right. I don't hold punches. Let me explain something. So here's what happened. You're just wrong,
Stefan. Face it.
But how does this prove IP is legitimate? What does it have
it
to do with
IP? It proves you're a sloppy writer and thinker. That's what it proves.
So what's your case for IP?
What's that? It will come along.
What is your definition of IP?
Be patient. We have 1 hour and 30 minutes, Stefan.
No.
We'll get there. I'm going to build the base. I am going to destroy you, Stefan. You were so wrong in so many places. It's incredible. But let's move beyond the book, okay?
I want to know what you think intellectual property is and why it's justified. Just give me one paragraph. I'm not going to do that.
You wrote the book. I did it. You wanted this debate.
This interview is not about my book. It's about whether IP is justified, Bob.
Yeah, and I'm trying to take a step-by-step process to go through. I don't want to take this
what
to some level where you have
IP?
It in the clouds. Step by step, Stefan, we're going to get there. Be patient, man. We'll get there. You have a problem with patience? You have a problem with patience? I would like to introduce Mises Hoppe into the debate right now. Okay?
Well, I'm not going to continue further until you give me a definition of what you mean by IP. You're justifying IP. You tell me what you mean by it. What do you mean by intellectual property?
I am building my base towards it.
We need to start out with definitions. I'm asking you a question.
Okay.
I want to know what you mean by intellectual property. I can't know what to disagree with you on, Bob, if you won't even define your terms.
Well,
what
you chose to debate this way. You chose this way of debating, not me. You agreed to it.
I didn't agree to let you ask me question after question and interrogate footnotes in a book.
Look. If you don't want to answer the questions, I'll just continue. I'll just take my 2 minutes and go on with my next point.
Well, I'll tell you what. I'm happy to answer questions. Unlike you, apparently, you ask me a question, I'll answer it. But then I'm going to ask you one. I would like you to answer my question.
I'm telling you, I'm getting there.
No, I don't want to wait till 54 minutes into it. I want to know, will you agree on my next question to answer my question? Simple.
Stefan, I'm going to answer the questions in the way it makes sense. I'm not going to let you pull stuff out of the air without the right, proper basis. The basis is I'm going to show you as a sloppy thinker, a sloppy writer, and that you don't know what the hell you're talking about. I have 16 points I have to go through to get to the point on my view of IP, and where you were wrong on 16 points before that, just like you're wrong on this Rothbard thing.
So
do you want to continue?
Your justification for IP is that Kinsella makes mistakes in his book. So if I had never been born, then there would be no IP justification.
No. My IP view has nothing to do with your views, thank God.
But does it have to do with
I want to destroy you because, A, you've got me really pissed off with the clown, worm, and weasel comments. That was really stupid, Stefan. And then secondly, you have a following in the libertarian movement, along with Jeff Tucker, and you're both so off. Your thinking is so bad, it is so sloppy, it needs to be destroyed.
I know,
that's what I'm going to do with
you, Stefan. All the Austrians and libertarians agree with us now. It must drive you guys nuts.
What's that? Well, Stefan, they won't.
Everyone agrees.
When I get through with this, Stefan, they're not going to be agreeing with very much of you. Let's go on. I now want to bring your attention to a book by Hans Hoppe called Economic Science and the Austrian Method. He quotes Mises in statements and propositions. If its statements and propositions are not derived from experience, they are, like those of logic and mathematics, a priori. Okay, he's talking about the science of economics. They are not subject to verification and falsification on the ground of experience and facts. They are both logically and temporally antecedent to any comprehension of historical facts. They are necessary requirement of any intellectual grasp of historical events. Would you agree with that, Stefan?
Oh, Jesus Christ. I probably, because I agree with almost everything Hoppe has written. I mean, this is painful for you just reading stuff that's tangentially related. I mean, you can't get to a defense of IP.
Basically saying you don't take empirical evidence and prove a theory by that. That's what he's saying. Do you agree with that or not?
No, I think that's a clumsy way of rephrasing what Hoppe said.
Well, first of all, that was Mises, not Hoppe. It was Hoppe quoting Mises, okay?
He didn't say what you just said. That was Bob Wenzel's paraphrase. I don't think that's a precise way of.
Well, I'm trying to make it simple for you.
Well,
you say you don't want to go through.
You're doing that.
All right. Well, let me try the Hoppe version then. Hoppe says non-praxeological schools of thought mistakenly believe that relationships between certain events are well-established empirical laws when they are really necessary and logical, praxeological ones. And they thereby behave as if the statement, a ball cannot be red and non-red all over at the same time, requires testing in Europe, America, Africa, Asia, and Australia. Moreover, the non-praxeologists also believe that relationships between certain events are well-established imperative empirical laws with predictive implications, when a priori reasoning can show them to be no more than information regarding contingent historical connections between events, which does not provide us with any knowledge whatsoever regarding the future course of events.
Make it stop. This is torture. Of course, I'm a praxeologist, dude, but listen, you don't have to be a praxeologist or even a Misesian or even an anarchist to oppose IP. All you have to do is understand
Stefan,
that there should be private property rights.
Stefan, please, I'm trying to establish something here.
God knows what.
You'll find out soon enough.
I really doubt it, Bob. You are all over the map, man. You are not a clear thinker.
Yeah, well, we'll see about that. On page 20 of your book, you say you have three reasons to reject utilitarian arguments. The one I found most interesting
is... Are you a utilitarian now, Bob? What the hell are you? Does anyone know?
Wait, did I say that?
Well, then why are you attacking my criticism of utilitarianism?
Maybe I'm not. I'm quoting you. I didn't say I was attacking you.
Now,
I'm quoting you.
Bob, all you do is carp and pick. You don't have any positive theory at all. I don't believe you do.
Well, like I said, be patient. You'll get there. In addition to this, it's your writing now.
When you're just quoting things in a podcast, I mean, Jesus.
Well, we'll get to the meat of this one in a minute. Trust me.
I think you're full of shit.
Okay, you don't have to trust me. Okay, I'll just read it, Stefan. It's here in your book.
Remember the clown thing earlier? This is an example of the clown thing. Go ahead.
Okay, well, let's see where it goes. In addition to the ethical problems, utilitarianism is not coherent. It necessarily involves making illegitimate interpersonal utility comparisons, as when the cost of IP laws are subtracted from the benefits. You go on to say, utilitarian analysis thoroughly confused and bankrupt. Do you still agree with that?
Of course.
Okay. So I found interesting.
Do I need to start my timer, dude? Because you're kind of monopolizing things. I'm going to give you 2 more minutes and I'm starting. Go ahead.
Okay. So you have a post up called Boldrin and Levine, The Case Against Patents. Okay.
Yes.
Now David Gordon writes in a review that their ethical views seem to be, broadly speaking, utilitarian. So in other words, you wouldn't agree with their utilitarian views to begin with. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, but yet, anyways, you feature apart from their book, which is utilitarian, which you don't agree with. And
who
then
knows
you write,
whether you are, because you won't answer any goddamn questions. I mean, I will tell you, I'm not a goddamn utilitarian. Okay, I have principles. I'm for property rights. I have a theory of property rights. I can tell you what IP is, why I disagree with it. You apparently can't answer a single question.
Well, but what you do here is you quote them, and then
are you even a libertarian? Can you just tell me, is a simple, are you a libertarian?
Yeah.
Are you an anarchist?
I consider myself a private property society person.
So you don't know, okay. Are you an anarchist?
It's not that I don't know. Look, let's get back on point.
Are you an Austrian libertarian anarchist, yes or no?
Depends upon how you define the terms. But anyways, I want to go back to this Boldrin Levine, The Case Against Patents. Now, this is where you get vicious. You say, we can only conclude. Now, this is after quoting utilitarians, which
are
bankrupt.
I wrote this before I'd even heard of Boldrin Levine, as you might know.
What's that? What?
This was back in 2099 when I wrote this, before Boldrin Levine even entered the scene, so I don't really know.
So are you no longer against utilitarianism?
I just told you I'm not a utilitarian at all. I've never been.
No, you're against it. Okay, so then what difference does it make when you wrote this stuff? In 2012,
What difference it makes to whether IP is legitimate or not? That's what I don't know.
I'm establishing for the libertarian community that you are totally sloppy and off the wall on this stuff, okay? Let me finish the quote.
If Stephen Kinsella, a patent attorney in Houston, is sloppy, that must mean Bob Wenzel's incoherent, undefined definition of IP is justified. I mean, what kind of way of arguing is that?
I told you what I'm doing. I'm trying to destroy you, man. You're right. We can only conclude at this point that people who favor patents on utilitarian grounds are either ignorant or dishonest who favor patents. So it's okay if they're against patents, but if they favor it, they are either ignorant or dishonest because of a paper that just came out. Maybe, Stefan, maybe it's because they didn't read the paper yet, assuming the paper makes any sense.
So then they're ignorant.
Yeah, ignorant in a sense. The paper came out last week. You don't know what I'm going to say for the rest of this debate, so you're ignorant to that. But that's not the implication you're giving, okay? Further,
so do you think utilitarians have a good reason for favoring IP, Bob? Do you think there are good utilitarian reasons for favoring IP?
No, but I don't.
You agree with me that utilitarians are wrong in their arguments for IP.
But you're saying they're either ignorant or dishonest. But let me ask you, here's the point.
Bob,
do you know what Boldrin?
Listen,
do you know what Boldrin and Levine's argument is?
What argument?
In the paper you cite.
What paper?
You cite a paper. You cite a paper. Here are the few lines from the introduction to The Case Against Patents, a paper by Boldrin and Levine. Do you know their argument? Were you calling it dishonest if a utilitarian is still in favor of patents?
Are you telling me that in my against IP, I call Boldrin and Levine dishonest?
No. You called the people who favor patents dishonest.
Yeah, I think they're either dishonest or ignorant, but that are utilitarian.
Yeah, but why? What in the paper would make them dishonest?
Bob, it's 4
You're
minutes.
Quoting a paper here, Stefan. What's in the paper, Stefan?
Bob, it's 4 minutes. It's my turn to reply, okay?
Okay, please reply. What's in the paper?
I'm not an empiricist. I'm not a utilitarian. However, people like you often mix together deontological and utilitarian or empirical arguments for IP, flip-flopping back and forth like little totally uncontrolled arguers all the time. And so you guys put up this argument all the time that you need IP as an incentive to create blah, blah, blah. That's why the founders put it in the Constitution. So you guys mount a positive case for IP based upon empirical or utilitarian concerns. And my simple reply is, number one, as a propertarian, as a principled libertarian, I don't care. I'm in favor of property rights and justice, and that is my main argument against it. Just like Ayn Rand and Rothbard would argue against laws, against antitrust, things like this, even, you know, without an empirical backup. But as a fallback, I'm saying, even by your own terms, in other words, you do not have an empirical argument for your case. And in fact, Bob, in the 200 plus years since the country has been founded, and since the founders had this hunch that you needed IP, copyright, and patent to incentivize innovation and creativity, there has never been a single unambiguous, comprehensive study that's proved this. In fact, they all prove the opposite. So what I'm saying is, if you're really a sincere utilitarian and you wanted to encourage creativity and stimulate innovation, if you were aware of the studies that have been done, you would have to say, well, God, I have to oppose patent and copyright because it looks like, from the evidence, that they deter innovation. So my point is, if you really know these studies and you're still in favor of IP while saying you're in favor because of empirical reasons, which you don't have, then you're dishonest and you have another agenda, which I think they do, or you're ignorant and you're not aware of these studies. Okay, so it's one of those two. It's a very logical argument to make. And in fact, okay, there are no studies showing that IP promotes innovation. It causes hundreds of billions of dollars of damage and wrecked lives and literal death, jail sentences, extradition, police state enforcement, SOPA, PIPA, the entire thing. These things are monstrous invasions of property rights. Bob, they are just below war, taxation, the Federal Reserve, government schools.
Okay, your 2 minutes is up. Let me ask you again. What is in the paper you cite? What is in the Boldrin-Levine paper, the case against patents?
Are you talking about the recent paper or the one I cited back in my original article? Which one are you talking about?
Tell me in either one.
Their basic argument is that they have studied from an empirical utilitarian point of view the way the IP system works, and they are taking on the primary claims of the people that promote it and that endorse IP, saying that it's necessary. So their basic claim is that it's not necessary to promote innovation and that it actually hinders it. That's their argument. And they give lots of examples and explanations.
Yeah, and what did they use? What data did they use?
I don't know what you mean. They use lots of data.
Yeah, but give me data from where?
Well, like Chapter 9 of their Against Intellectual Monopoly goes in detail.
Not against intellectual property. You're referencing the case against patents.
Yeah, but that's a summary of their entire argument. They elaborated it in detail, and they're against intellectual monopoly. So, for example, Chapter 9 talks about pharmaceuticals, and they just demolish all the myths about why patents are quote-unquote necessary for the innovation of pharmaceutical drugs. And they rely on tons of regularly established data. I don't know what you want me to tell you.
I'll explain because the paper is different. Stefan, you're babbling on because you didn't read the paper, okay? You're just attacking. You don't know what's in it. You can't tell me one damn thing that's in the paper.
You tell me what's in a paper that I cited in an article 12, 13 years ago?
This is September 12th, 12, 13 years ago. September 5th, 2012. What the hell are you talking about?
Oh, yeah, no, this is – yeah, that's why I was asking you. Were you talking about my original paper or something?
So I was giving you either one. So what's in the paper?
Their paper concludes that there's
no – not what the paper concludes. What's in the paper, Stefan? Did you read the paper?
Of course I read the paper. I read their whole book.
What's in it? What's in it?
What do you mean what's in it?
What's in the paper? Stefan, don't be stupid. What's in the paper? What is their argument? What is their argument?
Bob, what are you asking? Why don't you tell me
what you're asking? I'm asking you, what is in the paper that you can go and you can say that those in favor of patents on utilitarian grounds are either ignorant or dishonest? What is in the paper?
What does their paper have to do with my claim about the general errors that utilitarians make that are proactive?
Because, Stefan, I'm trying to destroy you. You piss me off. You're sloppy. You're not clear.
You're not making sense.
You don't do your homework. And I'm showing. This is only step two. I got 14 more of these, Stefan.
We're not going to get
Look
through.
Look at the paper.
You're just trying to evade.
Let me tell you what's in the paper, Stefan.
For IP.
Let me tell you what's in the paper. This is what they wrote because I read the paper. According to the Bureau of Labor, they have exhibited any particular uptrends. According to the Bureau of Labor of Statistics, annual growth in total factor productivity in the decade 1970 to 1979, they quote 1990-99, 2000-2009, they say growth was only about 1.2%. Meanwhile, U.S. research and development expenditures increased at 2.5%. So isn't that, first of all, an empirical view that you would object to and that not necessarily even a utilitarian would agree with? And a utilitarian can be against the empirical, like you are, but still be utilitarian. So this argument would make no sense to them, as it should not to you if you agree with Mises and Hoppe that I quoted. Am I correct?
Yeah, I'm not a utilitarian, but
why would you say a utilitarian is dishonest because of this paper? But let me move on.
No. First of all, I'm going to answer now. First of all, I didn't say utilitarians are dishonest because of that paper. What I
you
said was,
certainly did.
Bob,
we can only conclude at this point, after you quote from Baldwin and Levine, that people who favor patents on utilitarian grounds are either ignorant or dishonest. And this is a paper you quote from, but you can't tell me anything about. Stefan, come on.
If people that are listening will just go to c4sif.org, just go to my resources page and the other links on there, I've got a blog post called The Overwhelming Empirical Case Against Intellectual Property. And what I did there was I tried to collect as best I could. It's not comprehensive. I totally admit that it's not comprehensive because there's too many papers to comprehensively read, summarize, link to, and they're not all linkable anyway. But I collected dozens of studies, and they are all pushing in the same direction. You have empiricist-minded people, and what they do is when they look at this issue, they all conclude – it looks like this system is distorting things badly. It looks like this system is causing lots of problems. It looks like this system doesn't do what it's claimed. It looks like we can't conclude because the data is ambiguous. So basically, there is not a single study that I can find anywhere. Now, if you can find one, show me, Bob. But I'm just telling you.
That's fine. Are you in favor of empirical research or not? Why are you quoting empirical people, Stefan? Why are you quoting this stuff when you said if you agree with Mises and Hoppe, it doesn't make any sense? You go to see if red balls are red balls in Africa and Canada. I mean, Stefan. Well, let me ask you this. Would you quote this, Bob?
I'm going to hang up if you don't shut the hell up. It's my turn. Now, you're going to play by the rules. I'm hanging up.
Go ahead, Stefan.
Probably
I
what
got
you want is to have some stupid blog post title. Now, listen to me. First of all, I don't know if you're literally retarded or what, but your argument here is one of the worst arguments I have ever heard in my life. It is literally stupid.
How?
It is stupid, Bob.
Well, tell me how. Tell me how, Stefan.
I am a defender because, like you, I think, although I don't know what your real motives are anymore, like you, I am a defender of justice and private property rights, human prosperity, freedom, the free market, this kind of stuff, as a general matter, okay? And when someone comes along and says, we need to have this government intervention, which I think destroys lives and destroys individual rights and harms property rights and harms the free market, and then they justify it by saying, well, we need to raise the minimum wage, or we need to increase the money supply, or we need to do X, Y, and Z because it will have beneficial effects, right? If you increase the minimum wage, we'll all be better off. If you have a tariff, we'll all be better off. There is nothing wrong with saying, well, what's your data for that? And then when they give you data, there's nothing wrong with saying, but the data shows the opposite. So even by your standards, even by the proponent of protectionism, even by their standards, their argument doesn't make sense. So there is nothing wrong. That's a completely legitimate argumentative technique to take someone's arguments on their own merit and show that they're flawed. Okay, so I have no idea what you're talking about. You're acting like I'm contradicting myself because I say I'm not an empiricist, and yet I'm pointing out the flaws in the arguments of empiricists. Actually, that buttresses my arguments. Of course their arguments are going to be flawed, because the practical is the moral, right? And justice dovetails with consequences and pragmatic things. There's no reason to expect that the data is going to show that we're all going to be better off when the government institutes a protectionist anti-competitive system of patent and copyright law, a system that allows people to censor people's free speech, to bully small people, you know, to distort the entire cultural landscape, right? And to allow large companies to form oligopolies like Apple, Samsung, Google, Motorola, right? To lock out small competitors because they have these explicitly anti-competitive grants of monopoly privilege, which you apparently are in favor of, although you won't admit it because you know it's going to make you uncomfortable to admit it. So now you tell me what's wrong with showing that a goddamn empiricist is wrong in the stupid data they come up with to promote their protectionist argument. You tell me what's wrong with that, Bob.
Well, Stefan, that's not what you're doing. You're using Boldrin and Levine.
Oh, you're full of shit. You're so full of shit.
Hey, Stefan, September 5th, 2012, I suggest anybody that wants to go to the post. It's called Boldrin and Levine.
This is pathetic. You have no argument for IP. You're defending one of the six most evil things the goddamn federal government does. You have no excuse whatsoever.
Stefan,
either come up with an
there.
Argument or you should beg forgiveness from all libertarians for supporting this evil, evil protectionist federal scheme. Give me an argument, Bob. Show me why ideas are property. Are you familiar with praxeology? How about Mises? You know, Mises says that action is the employment of scarce means, guided by knowledge. Now, libertarians believe that there should be property rights means, not in the knowledge. Knowledge is an inexhaustible free good that once you are aware of knowledge, you're free to use it to guide your actions whatsoever. Your attempts to protect IP is an attempt to apply property rights to knowledge, which is not a scarce means. Now,
Let's go on. Page 32, you write, similarly, if you copy a book I have written, I still have the original book, and I also still have the pattern of words that constitute the book. Thus, authored works are not scarce in the same sense that a piece of land or a car are scarce, okay? But how do you mean that? You're basically,
I mean that the way every economist on the face of the earth means it. This is not controversial.
Okay, go ahead.
Have you ever heard the word rivalry? Do you know what rivalrousness means?
Go ahead. Yes, I do.
Do you think any economist on the earth would disagree that a pattern of words in a book is a rivalrous scarce good? Really? Anyone? Seriously?
That it's not. Let me tell you this. I have written out, okay, a formula that I think works to allow me to get on Drudge, a link on Drudge, which drives tremendous traffic to me from time to time. Okay.
What do you mean you've written it? What does that mean?
I've written it on a piece of paper.
Why?
Okay?
Why'd you do that?
Why did I do that?
Yeah.
Because I wanted to remember it in detail.
Okay. What's the relevance of the fact that you wrote it?
Well, the point, the
what
relevance
do I care
is
what you did with your property in your house. You have a piece of paper on your desk somewhere with lead or ink scratchings on it, which you can read, which means something to you. Congratulations.
Okay, yeah.
Miracle.
Okay. Then I sell this to person B under the condition that he does not sell it to anyone else. Is it, first of all, when I have it, is it a scarce good?
When you have what?
When I just have it written down and no one else is aware of it, is it a scarce good?
Is what a scarce good? You got to be specific.
What I've written down.
Paper? What do you mean? What you mean the pattern?
The formula itself.
Are you talking about knowledge?
The formula itself.
Knowledge?
If I'm the only one that has it, does anyone else have
what?
It?
Bob, tell me what the hell it is. Do you mean the piece of paper?
The formula to get on Drudge, to get a link on Drudge.
No. Is it the information or is it the piece of paper? Which one are you talking about? I'm not going to answer the question until you tell me what you're asking about.
Well, let's start with the formula itself. I have a formula. I'm aware of it.
Actually, you don't have a formula. You know, let's be precise. You know a formula, right? You are aware of a formula. It's in your head.
I'm not aware of the formula. I know the formula.
Yeah, you know it, but you don't have it. You know it. It's knowledge.
I certainly do have it.
Where
do
is it? Does it have a location, really? Is knowledge a locatable
thing? Well,
hold it.
Is location necessary for scarcity? I have the formula and nobody else has it.
How do you have it? What do you mean by you have it? I'm asking.
I have it in my brain. I have the knowledge.
Where?
In my brain.
I thought it was on the paper.
I put it there also, but that's just two.
And
that's
now
another place.
The same information's in two places?
Yeah.
Well, that's amazing. Maybe we could put it in a million places.
Yeah, but it's not there now. So is it scarce or not when it's just in two places?
No, information is not scarce.
So who else has it besides me then, if it's not scarce?
You don't have it. You know it.
Stefan,
are you
you're
telling
you're
me the possibility?
Who else can use it, function? Look it. Who in the world besides me can act on that if I'm the only one that has that formula?
No one, only you.
So is it scarce or not scarce? Is it super abundant everywhere?
It's not scarce. It's not a scarce resource. It's not a scarce means of action.
It's not scarce? Who else has it, Stefan?
What has it?
What?
No one has it.
Right. So it's scarce, isn't it?
No.
It's not?
No.
What's the formula, Stefan? Scarcity. What's the formula?
Okay, so here's Wenzel's argument. Stefan Kinsella doesn't know private information in Bob Wenzel's head, therefore patent and copyright are valid.
No, therefore it's scarce. There are scarce
ideas,
Stefan. Is it scarce or not? It's not scarce, but you don't know what it is.
It's information. I know exactly what it is.
Well, tell me the formula then.
This is a stupid argument, Bob.
How is that stupid?
Here's the way a real libertarian looks at this issue. Okay, someone who's not a clown. Okay, you have a property right in your brain and your body. This is a scarce resource. You have the legally recognized right to control, to be the exclusive one who can control your body. Guess what that gives you, Bob? That gives you the ability to act, and it gives you the ability to keep your mouth shut if you don't want to tell people your secret. It gives you the ability to keep secrets. It gives you the ability to run around your lawn naked at midnight, you know, worshiping the moon if you feel like it. Okay? That doesn't mean that you own this ability to run around. It doesn't mean you own your actions. It doesn't mean you own your labor. It doesn't mean you own the secrets in your head, because those are not ownable things. You have the practical ability to keep it private. There's no big deal. This is an issue.
So, Stefan, is it scarce or not? Stefan, when I have it, I'm not asking you what I'm doing with it. I'm asking you specifically, is it scarce knowledge, or does everyone have it? Does every blogger in the world know this?
No, but you're assuming that if everyone doesn't have it, it's scarce. Scarcity
means
scarcity means rivalrousness. You understand that? It's an economic concept, rivalry. Okay.
Well,
every economist in the world would agree that the information in your head is a pattern of information. It is not a rivalrous object. That means it cannot be owned.
Well, whatever kind of object it is, there is something. Would you admit I have a formula?
In a metaphorical sense, yeah.
In a metaphorical sense. It's a very real formula that I can act on.
Because you have to be clear about what have means. When you use have, you're
something that I can use and act on. I can act on it, Stefan. It's not metaphorical.
You can act on it. It's information that can guide your actions.
Exactly. You know, word it however you want there, but it is still information I have.
Theology. I thought you were a Misesian. Mises talks about human action being the use of knowledge to employ certain causally efficacious scarce means to achieve a result. Right? So the knowledge plays one role and the means play another role. So no, a knowledge is not a scarce means of action. I don't know how much more clear I could be, or that Mises could be.
So you're saying it's super abundant? The my formula is super abundant? What are you saying? Who else is acting on it? Is it not scarce, Stefan?
It's not scarce because it's not rivalrous.
What do you mean it's not rivalrous?
Something that's rivalrous means there can be rivalry or conflict or clashing over it. How could you and I have a conflict over that information, Bob?
Very simple, because if I sell it to B, okay? What?
Give me an answer. How can you have conflict over the information?
I'm attempting to do that, okay? If I sell it to B, okay, under the condition that he not show it to anybody else, or and he breaks that contract and shows C, then C is a rival of mine. If he attempts to sell that to other people, I am trying to put the same.
He's not.
You don't think there's movement on the supply curve? You don't think it's movement on a supply?
This is not rivalry. That's not what rivalry's about. Rivalry's about a specific type of good that can only be used by one person at a time, that there has to be conflict over.
Why is that the definition? There is certainly rivalry.
Look it up.
There is certainly – no. There is certainly rivalry between me and person C.
If I am
selling something and he's selling the same thing and driving the price down, that's not rivalry.
I disagree completely. Let me explain to you why. What you're using is equivocation, not on purpose. I don't think you're doing it on purpose, but you're getting confused with imprecise use of terms and overuse of metaphors. Let me give an example.
I'm not using any metaphors.
Hold on. Let's try to be a little, intelligent for a second. Sometimes people say people fight over religion. Now, this is actually not literally true. What they mean is that religion is the motivation for why they fight over scarce resources. The scarce resources are always like land or people's bodies. So, for example, if I'm a Muslim and you're a Christian and I tell you I want you to convert to Islam, what I mean is I want you to go through certain motions with your body, and that if you don't, I might kill your body. So what I'm saying is I have the right to use your body despite your will. So it's always a conflict over bodies. Now, people would describe that metaphorically as a fight over religion. But the religion is just the justification they would give for why it's okay to use someone's body without their permission. But the dispute is always about a conflict, a conflictable rival or scarce resource, namely your body or your land or something like that. Okay? In the same way, in the dispute you're giving, we're talking about money. Okay? So what you're saying is if C doesn't respect the contract between A and B, then C can compete with A, and that
rivalry
competition is not rivalry on the free market, is not rivalry at all in this sense. And you've got to know
what?
This, Bob.
You know, Stefan, you don't even know what the hell you're talking about now.
Let me finish my thought. I think you're confused. If someone competes with you, they are competitors on the free market, and it is true that C might take some sales that you would have otherwise made. So the real claim is the money in the pockets of these customers that goes to C instead of goes to A, right? So what you're really saying is that because of your cockamamie IP theory, because you don't like competition, because you had a contract with B, A thinks he has a property right in the money that customers gave to C. Now, how did he get this property right, Bob? You tell me. Because as far as I know, the customers owned it, and then they gave it voluntarily to C, who didn't violate any base cover property.
All right, your 2 minutes are up. I want to quote Hopper from your book.
Why don't you answer one of my questions once? Why don't you answer what I just said?
I don't want to. I'm here to destroy you and show that you don't know what the hell you're talking about. I mean, any reasonable person is going to know my knowledge, my formula of how to get on Drudge is scarce, and that people don't have it out there. And if somebody else gets it, that person is in rivalry with me. I mean, Stefan, that's just common sense.
Well, yeah,
I don't have to defend it any further. If anybody else agrees with you, Stefan, they should follow you wherever the hell they want. Okay.
Let me quote from page 29. Hold on. No, I'm not going to go back to the quoting right now. I want to ask you a follow-up question. Serious question. Let's suppose you have a drugstore, okay? You have a certain clientele of customers. Now, a competing drugstore opens across the street. Would you call that rivalry?
Of course.
Okay. And so if they take some of your business, are they stealing something that you had a property right in?
It's a rivalry.
Are they doing anything?
There's different kind of rivalry is competition. If they stole my products and sold my products, that would be stealing.
Now your question begging. Your question begging because you're
assuming. Oh, no, Stefan, I got you by the balls there. Let's go on. Page 29.
You're not going on.
You quote Hoppy.
Bob, I'm not. I'm going to hang up if you keep doing this. I'm telling you right now, dude, you're monopolizing it, which is fine to a degree. But I want to have a conversation about this. You can go on to your next little pointless question if you want. But I want to follow this because you're saying I'm trapped when you're the one making no sense whatsoever.
Go ahead.
Why don't you distinguish for me competition that's permissible versus competition that's not permissible?
Okay. If a person sets up a pharmacy across the street from me, that's rivalry. There's no question about that. If they buy it from the same manufacturer.
Not true. That is questionable, but go ahead.
All right. But if a person sets up a pharmacy across the street from me and at night goes in and breaks and steal all the drugs from my pharmacy to sell them in their pharmacy, that's rivalry, but it's also theft.
Yes, but Bob, we both agree on that. And don't you – that's why I started out this conversation by saying that you and I already agree on the basics of property rights in scarce resources. So what you're doing here, what you're doing is you're trying to make an analogy. What you're saying is just like it's theft of my products when you steal and break into my store and take some of my stuff, similarly, in the case you gave, the knowledge that B gave to C is also a stolen product. But you're question begging because we don't agree that knowledge can be – an ownable thing. Don't you see? This is the problem. You have to have a problem.
Yeah, I'm going to get to that. I want to go in the proper order of my presentation here.
No. Let me ask you one small question first. This is more of a preliminary question. Do you agree with me that you cannot establish something by engaging in question begging? I mean, just as a general matter, do you agree with that?
Why would I not agree with that?
Just making sure. So, would you agree that if you tell me this is property because it's wrong to steal it, that's not a good argument? Because you understand stealing implies that there's something owned to be taken in the first place. You can't show that the something
– I will get to that.
I want to know if you agree with me on that. Or do you think you can prove that something is property by just labeling the taking of it theft? Is that how you actually show what property is, by just calling it theft?
I'm going to get to that, Stefan. There's a couple of steps, and I don't want to confuse.
You can't even
I'm trying to get there, Stefan. From your own book, page 29.
So your argument is so weak that you're going to rely on something so stupid later that you can't even admit right now that that's a shoddy argument because you don't want to.
No, I don't want to get out because you're going to take the debate in areas that I don't want to go. I want to do two things. I want to show how weak and sloppy your arguments are. You're off on Rothbard. You're quoting books to bash people when you don't even read the paper. You don't even know what the hell they're saying. Let me turn to page 29 here. You quote Hoppe. Only because scarcity exists is there even a problem of formulating moral laws. Insofar as goods are superabundant, no conflict over the use of goods is possible. Why are you quoting Hoppe that way? What is superabundant about my formula?
Well,
that's what Hoppe says, and you quote him. What's superabundant about my formula?
Your formula is not superabundant, but it can be copied unto infinity.
Yeah, but it's not superabundant. It's not superabundant, Stefan.
Hoppe's using...
You're quoting Hoppe. You're quoting Hoppe on superabundant.
But you don't have an argument,
dude. That's scarcity. The scarcity, and insofar as a good, it's... And the lack of scarcity, insofar as a good, is superabundant. You're quoting Hoppe there, Stefan.
I don't know what your argument is supposed to be here. This is kind of...
My argument is... How is my formula superabundant? Even if A, B, and C have it, there's no superabundance there.
You see, you're not making a coherent argument because you didn't start from fundamentals. You're not defining your terms. Hoppe is trying to explain why the institution of property has arisen and must arise only because of the existence of rivalrous or scarce resources. Okay.
Right.
So as a thought experiment, like if you're familiar with calculus, which probably you're not, but you know, there's something called the limit in calculus, which is Hoppe is saying that as things get more and more abundant in reality, as they approach what's called superabundance, and he uses the idea of the Schlaraffenland or the land of milk and honey, it's like Rothbard's evenly rotating economy. It's an ideal construct that can never exist in reality. But what he imagines is you're in a land where things are so abundant that there's no possibility that you'd be ever short of it or that people could even take it away from you. So it's sort of like the idea of abundance gone to the limit would approach non-scarcity. So for example, if we lived in a land of where we're just kind of ghostly things and everything is a magically, you could just come up with something in the blink of an eye, like there's an infinite number of bananas everywhere and you could reach your hand up and grab a banana. You've got the banana. Well, in such a land, property would never arise as a concept because, number one, no one would ever want to take my banana from me because they can have their own bananas at any time. And if someone did take my banana, I wouldn't care because I could conjure another one up in the blink of an eye. So he's coming up with an ideal construct to explain why property rules arise and why they have to relate to scarce resources, that is to rivalrous things. We do live in a world that is not this land of milk and honey. It's not the Garden of Eden. We live in a world where there are scarce resources. These are what Mises talks about as the means of action. And we libertarians believe in property rights to assign an exclusive owner to each possibly contestable resource. That does not include knowledge. It includes scarce resources. I don't know. This very simple concept, a lot of people seem to get it. I don't know what problem you have with it. If you have an alternative theory, why don't you tell me what your alternative theory is?
Stefan, my alternative theory is that ideas are scarce, okay? And they're not superabundant the way Hopper references.
Okay, so you think ideas are scarce, so you think ideas should be one of the types of things ontologically that's a type of subject to property rights, right? So in other words, you would probably believe that we need to have property rights in intellectual property rights in more things than the current law covers, like we need it in fashion recipes and newspaper headlines and recipes for pizzas and bar drinks, and also they shouldn't terminate after 17 years or 25 years or 120 years. They should never terminate. After all, they're a property right, right? So by your theory, we would all have to be walking around getting permission every second of our lives from every bit of information we used. And in fact, every inventor of a new idea, Bob, do you understand that they relied upon other ideas? Because none of us is born tabula rasa into the world. You know, we all are born assuming all the knowledge that other generations have come up with before. No idea anyone comes up with is just totally brand new, ab nihilo, right? This always builds upon other people's ideas. So basically, you're advocating a world of total stultification and communism, where you have to get permission from everyone to perform any action, and we would all just die, because you could never get permission from everyone to do anything. Let me say one more thing, and then you can reply. I'll make an analogy to what you're doing. You have the mindset, you don't seem to appreciate the terrible harm that granting new rights does, although you probably do appreciate it in the context of money and in the context of welfare rights. So, for example, most simple-minded people who don't have an appreciation of economics sort of equate money with wealth, because you can use money, money's a sign of your wealth, or you can use it to acquire objects that you value. And so they don't understand why we don't just have a minimum wage, or why the Federal Reserve doesn't print more money. You and I understand what inflation is. You and I understand that if the government prints more dollars, it doesn't make us wealthier. All it does is redistribute wealth and set the business cycle in motion, correct? Same thing with welfare rights. You know, most liberals of today, socialist welfare-type liberals, they say, well, I'm in favor of property rights, but I'm also in favor of the right to an education and the right to a house and the right to a job and the right to XYZ. They don't understand that these rights come at the expense of existing rights. Like, if you have the right to a job, if you have the right to an education, that means someone else has to have an obligation to provide you with that. So all these artificial rights that the state wants to create, inflating money dilutes the power of money, right? Inflating rights dilutes the value of existing property rights. If there's a right to welfare, now my property rights are less secure because the government's got to take some of it, right, to provide welfare for people. It's exactly the same with intellectual property. The libertarian Lockean idea is already complete, Bob. It has an answer for every possible dispute.
Stefan, I really don't want to hear that stuff.
I know you don't.
Get back to the point.
You apparently don't want to hear any ideas.
It's babble. You're talking about me quoting Mises and Hopper, and you're babbling on stuff that has nothing to do with the simple fact that ideas are scarce. Okay, and you can't get away from that.
Before you go on, here's a quote from Hoppe. I'm actually at least giving my own thoughts here. You're just quoting things, but here's something from Hoppe in '88. Before I even started writing about IP, someone said in an audience, they said a panel question to Hoppe and David Gordon and others. They said a question for Hoppe: does the idea of personal sovereignty extend to knowledge? Am I a sovereign over my thoughts, ideas, and theories? Now Hoppe's answer is this. In order to have a thought, you must have property rights over your body. That doesn't imply that you own your thoughts. The thoughts can be used by anybody who is capable of understanding them. Now, see, you Hoppe recognized early on, because he is so deep into Misesian praxeology, he recognized, even without thinking about it a lot, he recognized the fundamental incompatibility, because of the praxeological structure of human action, the fundamental incompatibility of trying to assign property rights to knowledge the same way we do to scarce means of action. These are two fundamentally different aspects of human action.
Stefan, can you right now demonstrate to me how I use the Drudge formula?
Can you tell me what I have in my left pocket?
No, I can't. And that's the exact point. Knowledge is scarce. It's not super abundant.
What's your argument,
it's
Bob?
It's not, Stefan.
So what? What's your argument?
My argument is you're arguing that ideas are not scarce.
Have secret information,
let me ask you this.
What you're saying
Let's try something simple. Do you understand multivariable calculus?
I used to.
Okay. Well, it's the extension of calculus from one variable and involves the differentiating into functions that involve multivariables rather than just one. That's a simple explanation.
Well, I don't know. Okay. I've done first calculus, second calculus, multidimensional calculus. I think you're talking about multidimensional calculus.
You explain it, and I just explained
linear algebra,
it to you,
differential
Stefan.
Equations. You know,
Stefan, I asked you a question. You couldn't tell me. I told you. Okay,
yeah,
that was knowledge I had
right,
that you didn't
actually
have. It's another case which this is something
yeah.
that's easily yeah. Available
derivatives
in any
and stuff.
Calculus book.
Yes, derivatives and stuff. Yeah, the Germans, they make good stuff. Derivatives and
Stefan,
stuff.
Stefan, the point is there's all kinds of knowledge out there, and not everyone has. It's not super abundant. It's just not. Men have to act to either think about it, to
so
develop
is your theory
knowledge,
that if,
to
if,
find
if,
it somewhere.
Is your theory that if Bob Wenzel can think of some conceptual referent in life that is not super abundant, then that means that we should have property rights in it? Is that your theory?
The theory is that most ideas and information are not super abundant. It's not like air. Air is super abundant. Bananas in paradise is super abundant. None of this stuff is super abundant. Hello?
Well, Bob, once you release the information, I mean, look, I've already admitted, if it's secret, you have the right to keep it secret because you have a property right in your brain and your body.
Stefan, if A, B, and C have it, that's three people. It's not something that's just maintained in my mind.
How did three of those people have incentive to
keep it quiet and not tell anyone else?
No, C has no incentive. What's C's incentive?
CS resource, Stefan.
What's C's incentive to keep it secret? Tell me what C's incentive is.
So they can sell it so more people don't understand.
No. What's C's incentive?
What?
So you're talking about...
So we could sell it. It's a valuable information. People would pay tens of thousands of dollars for it.
Well, but then 3, 4, 5, 10 people know, right? Pretty soon it's public, right?
Yeah, okay. So it's not. No, it's not. See, you start contracts, constructs which are not necessarily true. There are ways to structure unlikely for that information to go beyond the people it's determined.
Oh, yeah,
it's really
unlikely. It's really unlikely. That's why we have to have SOPA and cracking down on piracy and the six strikes.
Hey, that's government, Stefan. That's not me and you,
no,
baby.
No. What I'm saying is it's not unlikely. Once information gets out, information can spread. This
See,
is the whole
you're,
point.
You're creating a straw man. If I tell you, I will tell you the Drudge thing, okay? But if that gets out to anyone, either because you do it on purpose or inadvertently or error or you're sloppy or you leave it on a park bench or whatever. But if it gets out and I can prove it's you, you will owe me $10 million, okay?
Either
not going to enter the contract
okay,
or B, you're going to enter the contract
okay.
and be very careful.
Let's get to the nitty-gritty here.
You can stop it from going.
Let's get to the nitty-gritty. Hold on a second, because this is really where you're going, although you don't want to admit it. You basically are trying to just justify Rothbard's original half-hearted argument for contractual copyright, which, by the way,
you're calling Rothbard's the time he spent on copyright and patent, we clearly thought it out in
no,
details,
he didn't.
Which
he
never
didn't
been
take it very
that
far.
Way anywhere else. Half-hearted.
He didn't even realize that it contradicted his defamation theories, which you apparently haven't read. I mean,
it doesn't contradict his defamation.
Yes, it clearly does. According to this logic, why don't you have a property right in your reputation, Bob? After all, you put labor into it. Why don't you have a property right in your reputation?
How would I have a property right in my reputation?
Well, it's valuable knowledge.
I never held that. What?
Okay, so hold on. So let's understand, by the way.
Somebody else has an opinion of me. Believe me, Stefan, I have an opinion of you, and you don't own that opinion. It's my opinion. It has nothing to do with you. It's my scarce resource.
But it's just knowledge.
It's not yours.
But it's just knowledge. That's the whole point. You can do with knowledge in your head whatever you want with it. Just like if I learn of your little drudge formula.
Right.
Hold on. If I learn about your drudge formula, why can't I act on it? Tell me why.
Well, it depends upon how you learn about it.
It does depend upon it. That's correct. So if you tell me, and we have a contract, you say, Stefan, you pay me $1,000, I'm going to give you this information, but you have to promise not to reveal it to anyone else. And if you do, then you got to pay me $10,000 damages. Whatever. I don't know. Something like that, right?
Right.
But we both agree with that. That's just contract law. You understand this has nothing to do with intellectual property. Nothing. It just means you and I can have a contract. The contract is about, by the way, the contract is about money. The contract is two title transfers. One is I'm transferring $1,000 to you now in payment for your performing an action that I want, which is giving me access to information. Number two, there's a conditional title transfer that comes later, which is my payment of damages to you if I do something with the information that you don't want me to do, right? So there's just two title transfers. That's it. That's what contracts are, as Rothbard explained. Okay?
So hold on. This is A and B. It's not super abundant at that point.
It's got nothing to do with
A
that.
And B
it's
happened.
Got nothing to do with that. A and B made a contract with each other. Okay?
Yeah, but you're going to come up with the scarcity argument down the road.
Forget scarcity for a second. Forget scarcity. So now let's say I'm
willing to forget. But you're going to bring it up that there is no scarcity.
Let's say,
okay. But I want to establish it at this point where A and B are involved. The knowledge is still scarce.
Bob, here's how the argument goes.
Scarcity, why won't you answer that question, Stefan?
I'm going to answer it. Scarcity just explains why we have property rights and what the function is. The libertarian believes that when you find a scarce resource in the world, that is some object that more than one person wants to use at the time and that only one of them can use, that's the possibility of conflict. We believe that the guy that homesteaded it first or that purchased it by contract is the one that gets to control it. That's it. That's the whole answer. And then the case against IP is simply recognizing that the only way to grant IP rights is to undercut these earlier homesteading rights. That's the whole argument. It's very simple. Okay? So you don't have to say it's not, it doesn't matter if it's scarce. In this case,
your whole argument
Bob,
is dependent
Bob,
upon
Bob,
lack
you
of
are
scarcity.
Relying apparently on this contract theory. So let's take it to the next step. This is the nitty-gritty. Now, you and I both agree that if I use the information in a way that you prohibited by our contract, then I'm doing something that's at least going to cause me to suffer some penalty because I agreed upon a penalty. But what if I tell the information to a third party and then they put it on the internet and then soon it's out for everyone? How do all these third and fourth and fifth parties, how are they violating your property rights because they never did enter into a contract with you?
Okay, well, let me explain that. I'm at Hertz. I rent a car.
No, but you're question begging. I know what you're doing. You're already question begging.
Stefan, I'm at Hertz. I rent the car, and I sell the car to someone else.
No, but we're assuming that the car.
Right
you and I.
To
no,
take the
you
car
can't
back
do this.
From C?
Bob, are you just. Are you unable to understand an argument? You have to at least understand what you're disagreeing with. I've already explained at least twice in this podcast, okay, that you and I both agree the car is a scarce, ownable thing. What we don't agree.
And
hold on.
See, that's why, Stefan, you have to identify it, A and B, that at that point, when A has information and I give it to B, there's scarcity of that idea.
But you understand you don't have an argument. Your argument is
circular.
It's
not super abundant,
your argument
Stefan.
Is circular. Do you understand why your argument is circular? You're saying
it's not circular.
You're saying information should be covered by property rights, should be a type of intellectual property, because it's an ownable thing that if you use it without permission, it's theft. You understand? It's just a totally circular argument.
No. I'm not talking about theft. It's not. It's not. See, it's not theft. You're the one.
No, it's if I use the Hertz rental car without permission.
If I rent the car from Hertz and then I sell the car to C,
You can't sell it to C.
What?
If C uses the car that Hertz owns without permission, he's committing a type of trespass, which is a type of
theft. Yeah, but maybe he doesn't know it.
Well, then he's doing it innocently, but he's still using property he has no right to use.
Exactly. So,
but we agree that it's property, Bob. We all agree the car is property.
So why can't I, as as the original person designing the contract, go to C and say, take that off your website.
Because the reason
it's not
the reason,
your property,
the reason
it was
that
given
the,
to you illegally, Bob, just the way the Hertz can with a car.
The reason the person, the third party, can't use the Hertz car has got nothing to do with contract. It's because there's in rem.
We're talking scarcity. We're talking property, and we're talking legitimate rights transfer. That's what we're talking about. And it's the same thing whether you're talking about a car or information. You may not like that fact, but it's a clear logical step as to why I can go to person C and say, hey, take that down. No. Hey, you got a copy of a book. You cannot sell that book.
Well, why don't we enter the year 2013 and stop talking about paper books left on park benches? I mean, information now is digital and it's on the internet. It doesn't have a physical substance, really. It's just patterns that could be duplicated perfectly forever. So, you know, if you go to Google or you go to some website and you see a copy of Bob Wenzel's magnum opus Proving Rights, which would probably have just two pages, you know, if I see that pattern of information.
You know, you're a real snippy bitch, aren't
well,
you?
Well, you're go saying ahead, you want to destroy me, so, you know, go. what do I care? You know, I think you're, I don't know, maybe Scientology messed you up or whatever it is, you know, I don't know. But, you know, why don't you tell me, Bob, where did the third person who sees information on the internet, where did I agree to a contract with the original creator of the information? Where's the contract?
Now you're creating a construct that has nothing at all to do with property rights. Property rights is not limited. Intellectual property rights.
Well, Bob, if I created the construct, then I guess I own it.
You own it, but it's an absolutely stupid construct.
I'll sell you my construct for 50 cents, and then I'll give you the right to use it. But
it's
only
not worth 50 cents. Oh, it's a piece of junk.
Well, I'd still deny your right to use my construct.
If something is on the web, we first of all, we have to know why it's on the web, what clauses or information limits what's on the web. If someone puts it on the web, it depends upon what the person is that puts it on the web is attempting to do. Is he trying to get that information out there for free or not?
I mean, about people putting things on the web, and it depends on their purposes. Yeah, okay, that's a good argument for IP so far. Continue. So far, I don't know a definition from you. All I know is you think if you have a secret, then
so Stefan,
you can sell
still
it.
You still haven't identified the difference between. A person C who has a car that is unknowingly belongs to Hertz, and a person C who is using a formula that does not gained through legitimate channels.
You know,
you may not be aware of that, but what's the difference?
You persuaded me, Bob. I think you're right. April Fools, but no, seriously, no, I can't think of any difference except for the fact that the car is a rival with scarce resource and the information is not. But other than that, there's no difference.
Why is it formula a rival or a scarce resource when only three people have it and it drives down the price of the price? How is that different
from the price?
From your
See, what are you, neoclassical? What's the price being driven down have to do with its nature as a rival with good? What's that got to do with anything?
Because what you're doing is you're introducing a further supply of a good. It's simple. That's basic economics.
I thought that was a good thing to increase supply of goods.
It depends on how you do it. If you steal the goods from somebody else, and you drive down the price in another market.
Well, who stole it in this case? So let's say A, B, and C have the information, and D overhears C talking about it or observes the product that embodies the information. Who is he? When did the theft occur exactly?
Okay, well now what you're doing is you're going into the enforcement and protection of IP. Okay,
so you're against enforcement of IP? Or?
No. My that's why I put up the picture at the Mises Institute. There are various levels and degrees of protection and enforcement, depending on what somebody wants. I mean, the Mises Institute has a sign up there, you know, no trespassing. At the same time,
so as far
Mises
as I can see, you have some cockamamie theory where if you can show that you can sell something for a price, then you need some kind of anti-competitive right to keep your market high and the price is high, and that makes it scarce in a sense. So it could be owned. But by your theory, you're as crazy as Galambos Iran. You would protect. You would have to protect things for far longer, Bob, than the current law does. In fact, for forever. After all, it's a property right. And you would have to protect things that are not protected now, like database rights,
my
recipes, fashion designs.
You can create any straw man you want.
It's not a straw man. I'm for competition. Party. You're apparently not for competition. You don't want competition on the free market.
Private property.
No, you call it rivalry now. You think competition
property?
Is rivalry. You really think
What's
competition
that?
Is rivalry. It's insane.
Basically,
did you get that from a bubblegum
package? If someone obtained something illegally, okay.
But that's question begging, dude. You can't say it's illegal in the argument for why it should be illegal. Do you understand basic argumentation? Jesus.
Well, that's why in the beginning I asked you about A and B and whether they had a contract and whether it was scarce at that point.
The contract scarce?
What's that?
What's scarce? The contract? The paper?
The formula. The formula. Is it scarce? I mean, in your strange world, it's super abundant or something. Okay?
It's infinitely copyable.
It's
infinitely copyable. Of course it is.
It's infinitely copyable. It's not the same thing as it being – not every blogger in the world knows now what my formula is to get on charge.
Bob, let me give you a simple hypothetical and see where we disagree. Okay? Let's try this. Okay? Let's say you and I both want to make a German chocolate cake. Okay? Now, we each have our own kitchen, our own house, our own mixing bowls, our own eggs, our own flour – right, our own oil, our own ovens. You would agree that these are all scarce resources, correct?
Yes.
You would agree that we would both favor a system where you have property rights. Excuse me, you have property rights in yours, and I have property rights in mine, correct?
Correct.
And you would agree that if we don't have these property rights, then we can't both use the same mixing bowl at the same time to make a cake, and that we might have conflict or violent clashing over this, right? You would try to take it from me. Instead of making a cake, then we're just fighting with each other, and then maybe one of us wins, but this is not civilized.
Go ahead. We agree with that, right?
But let's say you and I both learned of my grandmother's or your grandmother's secret recipe for making a German cake, and we're both following that recipe at the same time. Do you agree that there is no limit to the amount of people that could simultaneously make a cake following the same recipe, right? But that each one of them would have to have their own scarce resources, their own raw materials, their own capital goods. But they could all use the same recipe at the same time. You do agree with that, right?
But they would have to have knowledge of the recipe to make
it.
They could all use
the same knowledge at the same time, but they couldn't use the same.
Not everyone would have the exact same knowledge about a recipe or anything.
It's good enough for government work. I mean, look, you and I can look up right now, you know, Captain Bojangles.
Where you're going with this.
Hold on. You and I could go Google. We could look up Captain Bojangles' Bloody Mary recipe, and every one of the 7 billion people on the earth could theoretically do that. They could all use this.
Yeah, but they're not all going to do it. They may not have computers. There's certainly a lot of people on the planet that don't have computers. Others may not have Google skills. Some may not know how to read.
Yeah, but the point is, I know. Let's say there's 100 people making this recipe at the same time, right? Now, I observe you making your Bloody Mary recipe, okay?
Right.
Speaking of which, I'm kind of craving one right now. So I observe you doing that. Now, if I walk down and I take your pitcher and your tomato juice and your Tabasco, then I'm going to prevent you from making your Bloody Mary. Would you agree with that?
Well, I'm sorry.
If I observe you making a Bloody Mary,
right,
following a certain technique, and I come and I physically take from you your tomato juice or your Tabasco sauce or your pitcher, then I'm going to prevent you from being able to succeed in your project. Isn't that correct?
That you're going to be able to prevent me from doing what?
From making your Bloody Mary. If I take your ingredients from you.
Well, you're talking about not the recipe. You're talking about the physical Bloody Mary.
If I just could take your ingredients from you, you won't be able to make your recipe, right?
Right.
That's why you would fight me. That's why you want property rights, because you want to be able to use these ingredients in peace. But suppose I observe you making the Bloody Mary, and I go get my own ingredients, and I start doing exactly what you're doing, and I make a duplicate Bloody Mary, right?
Right.
Now, how does that prevent you from engaging in your business? How does it prevent you from succeeding at the task you set for yourself?
again, you know,
no,
you're
just
creating
just go with me. Go with me.
I
answer
will
the
explain
question.
It to you. Okay. All right.
Do you think it does prevent you? Do you think it really prevents you?
I'm going to explain it to you. It is still a super abundant thing. Not everybody in the world knows how to make a Bloody Mary.
But if a person
is stealing that from me, it actually proves
my point. How would they steal it? You mean by observing you? Does that steal it?
Yeah. Well,
wait, back. Are you saying that if I observe you doing something and I learn from your behavior,
let me say taking it. Okay.
But I'm not taking it. You still have it. I'm not taking it. What do you mean taking?
He takes it for his own
use. He's not taking it, Bob. You still have it. How is it taking?
Stefan.
You mean he learned. He learned by observing, what you're saying. He learned by observing.
All right, we'll go with the word he learned.
He learned.
To the point.
So are you against learning now?
The point is, are you going to give away all your legal education for free and stuff like that? I mean, Stefan,
Bob,
come on.
If the guy is doing something, let me get back to the point. If you're performing an action in public,
it's not super abundant.
If you're performing an action that people can learn from what you're doing, that's called competition. That's called learning. That's
emulation. Yeah, but you just created a straw man where you said everybody knew this, everybody could look it up. Yet at the same time, you're telling me about a guy that doesn't have the information. It's a scarce good.
What's wrong with learning from other people, Bob?
Look it. I've had economists steal some of my stuff. Okay, where I wrote critiques of.
It's not stealing. You got to quit using that. That's question, but that's an illegitimate tactic because I haven't agreed that IP is a type of property. So you keep calling it stealing.
Interpret it in your own world. I consider it theft. Okay?
Well, you can consider it whatever the hell you want, but that doesn't mean that is you're right. What's your argument?
It doesn't mean you're right either.
Bob, I have demonstrated very clearly that I gave you the example earlier. Let's try this, because in my mind, I've thought about this from 17, 25 different angles over the years. And to my mind, the
clearly not enough, and you're sloppy about your work, but go ahead.
All right, the clearest way of explaining or understanding what's wrong with IP is the restrictive covenant negative servitude idea I gave earlier. Now, would you not agree with me that I can do whatever I want in the privacy of my own home as long as I don't, number one, commit a tort against you, like invade your property, like shoot a gun into your property or pollute into your property, or if I haven't given you a contractual right to prevent what I can do with it? Wouldn't you agree that that's the only way that you have the right to stop me from doing something in my own property? In other words, suppose the government says, "Bob, we're gonna enact zoning laws, and we're not gonna let you put two stories onto your house." Don't you think that's a taking of part of your property rights? That they're acting like a partial owner of your property with you?
Stefan, you have this block that if something isn't physical, it's not property.
No, but we both agree that physical things at least should be property. That's what we agree on, right? Do you agree that it's right? Do you agree that it's right that the government can tell you that you can't use your property in certain ways, your physical property?
Oh, I see where you're going. Yeah, you're wrong. You're really wrong on this one.
Hold on. Just answer the question.
Yeah, let's go. Yeah. I'm with you there, but you're... Go ahead. Take this one. Go ahead.
So you agree that if someone acquires the legal right to veto your use of your property, that is a taking of part of your property rights, unless you gave it to them voluntarily, that is by contract. Wouldn't you agree with that? I mean, it's just a simple thing. I'm not trying to trap you. I just think this is the way property rights works. I mean, let's say you and I are neighbors, okay, Bob? And let's say
you can, but again, there are limitations to that. For example, if the person shoots into my property, he can't do that.
Likewise, if
he somehow gains some information
hold on,
attempts to use that on his property, even though he did not acquire that information in a valid manner.
What's that mean, valid? That's question begging. What do you mean, valid manner? What's a valid manner?
Yeah, I'll explain that to you.
What's a valid manner?
If I will explain it to you. If I have a formula for getting on drudge, which I sell to somebody B on the grounds that he not reveal it to anybody else.
No, let's
and
be
then
specific.
He goes to my neighbor.
Be specific. What's your
and
contract?
Then he goes to my neighbor.
No. I want
to
know what your contract.
And says here's what.
Be specific. What? What's the contract? You and your customer. You're telling them what? They have
right.
to pay
customer,
you for information, and they also have to agree to what?
To not reveal it to anyone
what
else.
Is that, what
in
does that
any
mean?
Other
not
manner?
Reveal it. They can. Can they use it?
They can use it to attempt to get links on drugs, but they cannot use it for any other purpose.
Well, what does
cannot
that mean?
Reveal it to anyone. What?
What does that mean? Can't use for any other purpose? Can they think about it? Can they include?
Yeah, well, they can think about it. I mean, yeah, we can put that in. Yeah.
Okay. So
if you're their lawyer and you want to raise these kind of ditzy things with them, yeah,
it's not ditzy because it matters here. So what I'm saying is, what if they use the formula as they have purchased the right to do apparently,
right?
And someone else observes them over time making a lot of money, and they sort of figure out what they're doing. Is that revealing the information or?
If it's no, that is another person independently gaining knowledge of the formula.
Oh, good. So you've apparently just given up the whole case for IP. So congratulations. I knew you'd agree with me eventually. You've just conceded there can't be IP. So very good.
No, it's
you believe in contract apparently.
You don't. See, this goes back to you don't understand Rothbard, because Rothbard believes in copyright and patent. He says independent discovery, okay, is not a problem.
What does it mean it's not a problem?
As far as limiting someone with regard to their use of an idea. However, what Rothbard means by independent discovery is by him thinking about it or doing something on his own versus someone under contractual obligation not to reveal it to someone else. That's not independent discovery in the Rothbard sense.
Well, patent law actually has no defense for independent discovery. So actually,
yeah, exactly.
So Rothbard doesn't defend patent law.
Well, Rothbard defends patent. Rothbard defendants patent law.
Uh-huh.
He just says it should be a different structure. It should be the same as read Rothbard. Rothbard is 100% in favor of copyright the way it is now, and he's in favor of patent law as long as it's structured the way copyright is. That's what Rothbard is all about.
Well, he can't be in favor of it the way
it
is now, because when he wrote in the 60s, the copyright term was about 20 or 40 years shorter than it is now. So which copyright term does he think is implied in the natural structure of the fabric of the universe? Is it like 40 years after
death? He would argue forever.
Oh, really? Well, that's not how copyright law is now. So Rothbard believed in copyright in perpetuity, you think? Really?
Yeah.
yeah, so he was as crazy as
Columbus. I mean, you want me to dig up the quote?
I would love to see Rothbard talking about perpetual copyright.
There's absolutely no way that... But anyways, talk about something, you know, some other thing. Now, let's see.
Well, Bob, you still haven't given your defense of IP. You know, you told me, hold on, I'm getting to it, Sally. But, you know, I ain't see no defense of IP. I don't see a definition
of it yet. Well, here's the defense of IP. Let me say it for you. Ideas are not generally super abundant.
Yeah.
They are scarce.
Yeah.
There is if a person has an idea,
yeah.
It's his, it's scarce. If he makes a contract with B,
uh-huh.
It is still scarce because it's between A and B.
Uh-huh.
And B, if he reveals it to C,
yeah.
Invalidates his contract in the same way that if I rent a car from Hertz.
Not the same way.
And
that's
sell it to
begging.
C. What's that?
It's not the same
it's
way.
Not
you're question,
question
begging.
Begging.
It is question begging. Won't you look that after we're done? Look up question begging. But so basically your argument is just Rothbard's confused contract argument, and which I've already debunked. So I don't know.
You haven't. You how did you debunk?
I got
all,
a whole
you
section in the article.
You hold it. First of all, you have Rothbard as being anti-copyright and anti-patent. You don't even understand Rothbard.
Rothbard was believed that you could create some aspects in a private society similar in some ways to modern IP systems by contract. Now, you shouldn't call it. He called it copyright because he's talking about putting a stamp on something.
The copyright is therefore a logical device of property right on the free market, quote unquote, Rothbard.
Yeah, that's what he said.
So he's in favor of copyright.
No, he's in favor. He's in favor of.
You're lumping him with people that are against copyright. He's not against copyright.
Well, he was against statutory copyright, and he was for a contractual scheme. He thought could.
What?
He was in favor of. He thought you could use contracts to replicate some of the features of the modern IP system, and he was wrong.
But you have him in a category where he's against IP, and he's not against IP. You're wrong.
So what, Bob?
What?
So
you're
what?
Bringing it up, not me. You're bringing it up. It's more sloppy stuff from you.
Well, Rothbard was a little...
Let me get back to my point. I am not begging the question. I am not saying that because...
You're making the analogy to the Hertz rental car case because you're assuming just like
just. But
that's
not begging the question. It's attempting to demonstrate.
Bob, let me tell you
why,
what I see. Hold on. Let me tell you the difference between the two cases.
Why you can have a property rights?
Bob,
okay, intellectual property rights.
Bob,
if A makes a contract with B and then C attempts with whether it's a book or whatever, and then now you want to go off into the megaland of the internet because you can't defend C printing books. You're in trouble there.
No,
I can't defend
C printing books. I would defend C's right to print books, and I think he's doing nothing wrong whatsoever. I actually do defend it because C doesn't have a contract.
Yeah, but see, it's the same thing. It's the same thing with how is that different from a car? How is it different
That's
from
your argument?
My
your argument is a question.
To rent
how is it
car
different?
And then selling the car.
Because, Bob, you and I, hold on. You asked me a question, so now you get to have an answer and. If you can listen, maybe you'll actually learn something, which I won't consider as a violation of my property rights. You and I both agree that there ought to be property rights in the car. So Hertz owns the car. They're loaning it to or leasing or renting it temporarily to someone for a restricted use for a temporary period of time. And they have a contract between them and their customer that specifies how this person can use the car. They can't drive it to Mexico and sell it for spare parts. They can't destroy it. They can't use it in a stunt in a movie. You know, they can only use it for certain regular uses that are specified in the contract. Okay, so if the owner of that, if the renter of the car loans it to his friend when the contract says you can't loan it to anyone not identified in the contract ahead of time, then here we have a scarce resource which we all agree is ownable and that in fact is owned and is owned by Hertz. Okay.
Hold on. I got to stop you because you know when you laughed your ass off at me saying Rothbard would be against perpetual copyright.
Yeah.
Well, I find the quote against Stefan. You do not know what the fuck you're talking about. His Rothbard quote unquote on the free market. Therefore, there would be no such thing as. Here it is. There would, however, be a copyright for any inventor or creator who made use of it, and this copyright would be perpetual.
That's not copyright, though. He's talking about contract, dude. He's not talking about copyright. That's what you don't understand.
I'll tell you what he's saying. There would, however, be copyright for any inventor or creator who would make use of it, and this copyright would be perpetual.
He's talking about his contractual scheme, which he's wrong about.
Hold it. Stefan, I got you by the balls again.
Rothbard was opposed to the copyright statute.
Stefan, I got you again. You don't know what the fuck you're talking about. I got you by the balls. You laughed your ass off when I said Rothbard would be in favor of perpetual copyright, and he says it right here.
Nope. Rothbard is in favor of
Stefan, you did not
ownership.
Say that. You laughed your last.
Yeah, you're wrong. You're
Stefan,
totally wrong.
You
He's not talking about... This is the problem
Stefan,
I tried to tell you earlier,
we'll
and you don't want to listen.
We'll let the listeners decide.
I'd love for them to. Rothbard is not talking about modern copyright systems or statutory. He's talking about his cobbled-together contractual copyright scheme. And because Rothbard believed that contracts are ways of assigning rights in scarce resources, he did believe those lasted forever. But his mistake is in thinking you could create with a contract something similar to modern IP. He does not believe in perpetual copyright. Nothing whatsoever like the modern advocates of perpetual copyright do. So you're just wrong. And so you, and still, so
he,
back
he did not believe in perpetual copyright when he says there would, however, be copyrights for any inventor or creator who made use of it, and this copyright would be perpetual, not limited to a certain number of years.
He's using the word copyright in a different way. This is the problem with equivocation. He's talking about something totally different. He is slapping the word copyright onto his contractual scheme idea, okay? Which is obvious that he's misusing it because he uses a mousetrap as the example, which is a patentable thing, an invention. It's got nothing to do with copyright. This is the problem with people who don't understand the details of the law, just slapping
and again,
these things together.
Stefan, you're wrong. He makes a clear distinction between copyright and patent. He knows a mousetrap is a patent needs to be applied to it.
So okay? Why does he use a mousetrap for the example of a copyright then? Why?
Because what he's saying is that the way patents should be constructed is the way similar to copyright. He's not confusing the two. You're confused.
He is confusing them.
No, he's not. He goes right out, Stefan, and says copyright currently is such and such. Patent is such and such. Copyright is because it's independent discovery is allowed, works. Because patent does not allow independent discovery, it's not the way it would work on a free market. However, if patent would work in the way copyright does, you could have patent on the independent market. And that's why he uses the example of the mousetrap.
Do you understand what he's saying? I fully understand it. Do you think that Rothbard...
Do
you think Rothbard believed in competition? Do you think Rothbard thinks that if someone puts a new mousetrap on the market, that other competitors are free to observe the structure and design of that trap and make a competing mousetrap using some of the innovations in that mousetrap? Do you think he believed that or not? Simple question.
I'm just asking you
if you think Robert believed in competition and free markets. It's a simple question.
See, but it's a lonely question because you're going to go and defend competition as being the theft of intellectual property.
Stefan,
I know what the hell you're trying to do.
No, you don't. You have no idea. You don't
question.
Know how to make an argument. You're doing all you've done.
I don't know how to make an argument.
No, you've been circular
arguments.
I just
showed you. You don't know Rothbard. You're quoting Bolger. You didn't even read the paper.
Stefan Kinsella can't quote a paper. Stefan Kinsella made a mistake.
Somehow you think my formula to get on Drudge is super abundant.
So
come on!
Theory, again,
you don't know
theory,
what the hell you're
anything that's
about.
Not super abundant, Bob Wenzel can own. I mean, what is this? You keep making the analogy between the Hertz rental car. The reason that the third party is committing a type of trespass when he's using that car without permission of Hertz is he's using someone's property without their permission. Now you come up with the red herring that well he might not know it, he might be innocent. It's got nothing to do with it. You're still not entitled.
Right,
to
Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. That's my point.
Yeah. So he can sue his friend, but he's using someone's property without their consent.
Intellectual property.
Hey, Bob. You know, if I'm away on the weekend and someone breaks into my house and pretends like they're the owner and they invite you over for a party, okay, and they say, "Hey, let's trash my house," and you do it, you're actually committing a type of trespass against my property. You might not know it, but you are actually using property that you don't own. Do you understand that? The reason is it's called what's called in the law in rem rights, rights good against the world, rights in property. You're trying to analogize contractual rights, which are in personam, just rights between two people. You're trying to use that, which is what Rothbard tried, to build up an in rem theory. It cannot be done.
Stefan, it can't be done in your world where you think my knowledge is not scarce, that I cannot continue
to keep it scarce by contract. In your world, there's no one else can be named.
And
Bob
then anybody
Wenzel,
that can go around and steal the information, and therefore, voila.
Well, what you call stealing, most people call learning.
Your framework is based on broken contract. I have never seen any other construct of any other theory based on broken. Your theory doesn't even start until a contract is broken. It doesn't become unscarce, although I don't even think it's unscarce at that point, but in your world until it gets to party C, D, F, and G.
My world is very simple. It's a libertarian world that we want to avoid conflict, and we want to have property rights in scarce resources so that people can use them peacefully and cooperatively and generate prosperity for all. Now, I assume you tend to agree with that, although the rules you're supporting would undercut that. You don't seem to understand that. You don't seem to understand that if someone has the right to, the legal right to veto how I can use my property when I'm using it peacefully and without committing any kind of trespass or contract breach at all,
that's taking away
my property rights. That's what you don't seem to understand.
Let me answer you on this point, okay? You're basically saying I'm preventing you from doing something on your property let's say you have a property and you want to build a house on it, okay? Mm-hmm. And you're saying because I have designed the house in a certain manner, which I have a copyright on.
No, you don't have a copyright on it.
What's that? Well, I'm saying I do, or a patent, whatever. It's written down, or it's...
You mean in your ideal world where you have a right in the designs of things?
No. Tell what would be the legal term if I have designed a way to build a house, a unique way to build a house. So is that a patent or copyright? If it's written down, how should it be determined? How would it be determined in current law?
Well, in current law, if you have a unique, inventive way, a functional, practical idea of how to build a house in a more efficient way, that'd be protectable by patent. But if you're talking about the actual architectural design and layout of the house, that'd be something more like copyright.
Yeah, so it's looking beyond. But so either way, well, let's say I have a copyright and a patent on it, okay? So then you somehow acquire my architectural design.
What do you mean somehow? I'm walking down the street, I see it. It's not somehow.
Suppose it's... Part of the design has unique functions on the inside where you can't see from the outside. So you really can't know how I designed the house.
How did I get the information? You got to specify. How did I get the information?
What? I'm sorry?
How did I get the information?
That's my point. Here's my point. You're saying that I am preventing you from designing a house like mine.
Right.
Okay? But... Under Rothbard's view...
You are. You're preventing me from using my property as I see fit. I'm not committing a trespass against you.
No. The only thing I'm doing is preventing you from somehow stealing the property.
But you're
stealing the formula.
Bob, that's question begging. You're calling it stealing. You can't call it stealing to prove that it should be classified as stealing. You understand? That's question begging. You've got to prove...
All right, let's say...
using information. How about using information that I have?
No, because you're question begging, man. I mean,
no, I'm not.
The point is, let me continue here. There is no way that I'm going to let the design out, okay? So there's no way person B is going to know how to construct.
Sometimes you can't help letting the design out.
Well, no. Well, let's say this is a case where I bury it in my safe.
Well, that could be.
And nobody
else
agree.
Knows. You can keep information secret, but let's specify something. You can keep information secret, and that's fine. However, you know, if you have a really unique method, first of all, if you patent it, you're going to reveal it to the world by patenting it, Bob. You have to reveal it. So I don't.
Well, no, that's under current law. That's not under Rothbard.
I don't think Rothbard would agree that you can get a government issued patent that you can keep the information secret, but still have a property right. You already admitted he's against
Rothbard. Rothbard wouldn't require disclosure of patents, but go ahead, continue.
The whole patent system is the whole idea is based upon the bargain between the public and the inventor, and the deal is
the public. Now we're talking about the public.
This is why I'm against this socialist
utilitarian. I thought you're not bringing utilitarian. Perspective. What are you talking about?
This is why I wouldn't support it. I don't think Rothbard would support it.
What?
The modern concept of patents.
He doesn't.
Yeah, but so my point is, if you get a patent, no, just listen. If you get a patent, the only reason to get a patent is because you want to commercially
exploit it. I can't believe you laughed your ass off when I told you Rothbard would want a perpetual copyright and patents. That's exactly what's in the thing.
Now he's in favor
vicious,
of patents.
Vicious,
I can't tell
vicious,
what you're... Now he's in favor of
vicious,
patents?
Like,
he's in favor of patents
what?
Now?
He's in favor of patents, not the current patent law.
Well, what kind of patents is he in favor of?
A patent that works along the lines of copyright, where it's independent discovery of ideas. Stefan, don't you know what Rothbard even said?
I know Rothbard didn't really understand IP law very well.
Please. He understands it a hell of a lot better than you do.
Oh, yeah.
And it's remarkable that your
Hey, Bob, if you ask any patent or copyright lawyer in the world, even a regular status one, if you could have a patent system modeled after copyright, they'll laugh in your face. Okay, it's like saying the Americans with Disabilities Act is going to be the tax collection system.
Rothbard addresses that, and he says most people do not separate copyright and patent; they see it as different things. And he addresses why that's a flaw.
I'm sure Rothbard. By your argument, Rothbard's in favor of a private analog of the Semiconductor Database Protection Act and boat hull designs. And moral rights and
Stefan,
defamation
you know
law.
He's not. You oh, know no. he's not.
Rothbard.
You're posing yourself as some kind of intellectual expert from a libertarian perspective, and you don't even understand Rothbard's perspective. When I tell you Rothbard's perspective, you try and intimidate me by laughing your ass off. When you really get your head stuck up your ass.
All I know is
now let's get back to this person next door to me. Let's get back to this person next door to me who's got a lot in lumber. I am not preventing him from independently building anything he wants, including
something very similar to mine. You're preventing him from learning from you and using what technique you've used. You're preventing him from doing
that. I have to tell him how I'm building it.
Did I say that?
I have to tell him how I built my house.
Did I say that?
What are you talking? What?
Did I say
well,
that?
Well, how is he gonna learn if it's the key to my house is what's inside the house?
How did he learn? I don't know. How? It's your hypothetical. How did he learn? I don't know how he learned.
He isn't. He can't. That's my point. But
well, then why do you need a legal right to stop him? If he can't learn, then why do you need a legal right to stop him?
What's that?
If he can't learn from you, why do you need a legal right to stop him from using information that he has no way of acquiring? Just keep it secret. That's trade secret law.
Yeah, but suppose I don't want to keep it secret. Suppose it's a great idea and I want to sell it.
Exactly. That's my point. That's why you would get a patent, because you want to commercially exploit it, and you're going to reveal it to the world when you do that. That's how he's going to learn. So you just said, how's he going to learn?
No, maybe he's not. If I sell it to person C, D, and E, and each one of those signs a contract that says, do not reveal how it's done, the person next door to me is not going to do it. However, that's not me preventing him from doing it, building his house that way. All it is him
it
preventing
is.
Him from doing it
from
because
stealing. Yeah,
I have told B, C, and D about it.
Yeah.
All it is saying if he can build it if he does it independently and discovers the way himself independently.
Yeah. Oh, no, it's very magnanimous of you. It's very magnanimous of you.
Stefan,
it's magnanimous of you to get permission.
Your proposition is that I'm preventing the person from doing that next door to me.
Your permission.
And I'm not doing that at all.
It is
you're wrong again, Stefan.
No, I'm not.
Stefan, you're wrong
my
again.
My position is that you believe in a communist. Listen.
Exact same house.
You
if
believe
he can come up independently and figure out how it's done, he can do it.
Bob, you believe in a totalitarian world where people have to live by permission, not by right, where to perform any action with their property, they need to get permission of this network of billions of people who are heirs of ideas that they come up with and perpetuated from the
past. Now you're totally distorting it.
No, it's not. It's the nightmare scenario.
First of all, you did not want me to bring up communism, dictatorship, fascist charges, and now you're telling me I live in a totalitarian, my view is totalitarian, where I'm going to require people to go through. No, if I have an idea
you're going to magnanimously allow people to build a house as long as they can show they came up with the idea originally. But no, you can't have learned anything from anyone, because then you're committing some kind of weird
that's
theft.
That is not true. It's independent discovery. If you discover it on your own,
nothing is independent,
Bob.
Nothing is independent. Everything borrows from the cultural stock of humanity. We all learn from each other. You ever heard of competition on the free market? You see someone doing something to make a profit, you start doing what they're doing. That's called competition. Nothing is independent. Nothing is completely original. You know this. All information is incremental. All knowledge and learning
yeah,
is incremental.
So it's not, Stefan. So
and
it's
a good thing. It's not a bad
stuff.
Thing.
So it's not that kind of stuff that would be protected under the intellectual
property. What kind of stuff
if
is it? You don't have an idea.
Known,
what kind of stuff is it?
My formula for getting on Drudge is something that's protected by intellectual property. You're creating situations where it doesn't
begging,
apply.
Question begging. You're saying it's protected by intellectual property in an argument trying to show that it should be protected by intellectual property. Look, if you reveal the information as a practical matter, Bob, let's be realistic. If you're gonna start making cookie cutter subdivisions with all these houses, you're gonna have to train a staff of people to do your technique. The information is gonna be public before you know it.
So I don't care if you have a contract
with a dozen people.
But this goes back to my picture of the Mises sign that says private property. It's a degree to which you want to enforce and protect your private property.
Mises, in addition to having a private property sign,
they could put a gate up, they could put armed guards, they could call health angels to guard the thing.
Every person on any
kind of property, whether it's private property, physical property, or intellectual property, can choose to what degree they want to actually protect that property.
Your argument is, if you can call it property, it's property.
There are costs involved with protecting property. So basically, if you have a situation where you're building houses, you realize that information may get out some way, and you have to determine to which degree you're going to try and attempt to protect against that. Are you going to go all out, put a gate, health angels, and everything else to protect a piece of private property or intellectual property or anything else?
Probably not. It depends upon the upshot of all this analysis. You've thought about it for years, and you have no argument except you kind of think Rothbard. One interpretation of Rothbard.
I kind of think. Listen, smartass. My view is that ideas are not super abundant. That you quoted Hoppe without understanding what he meant by that. That ideas are scarce in many cases.
This is painful. Oh, it's so agonizing.
It may be painful. Tell me what my idea is about the drug formula.
No, the point is you don't even know how to argue. You have no point. You're repeating yourself. You basically act like you've got this momentous idea.
All you're doing is repeating. Just like you did when I proposed that Rothbard said he was in favor of perpetual copyright, which he is.
Or patent.
You're laughing again.
Maybe patents, maybe copyrights, but not vulnerable. It may win over
one of your clueless followers, but it's not going to fool anybody else. The point of the matter is that my drudge formula is something that I have. It's scarce. If I sell it to BC and D, it will continue to be scarce.
In my world, tough shit, because people are going to compete with you, and there's not a goddamn thing you can do about it. So you can sit there and come up with a new idea, or you can find a way to compete and lower your prices, but you can sit there and fume and complain all you want. But in my world, there's going to be competition and free markets, and even people you don't like it, you can't go to any government to get protection from competition. Sorry. If you want to reveal information to the public as the price of having to be able to sell it, then hey, people are going to learn from you and compete from you. It's a very simple idea. This is the Misesian,
Rothbardian free market idea. You're distorting the idea of selling something with how I want to protect what I have. If you read Rothbard's title transfer theory of contract,
you'll understand that you're making a mistake with your selling idea.
You don't understand Rothbard. It's clear right from the beginning. You don't understand it. You attack with articles that you don't understand, Stefan. It's a disaster.
Yeah, I know. Okay? You've totally destroyed and trounced me, Bob. You've proved there should be IP. I know it's great. I know.
You basically have a formula and a framework that doesn't even kick in until a contract is broken. You should be ashamed of yourself with such a theory.
Okay.
When property is respected, whether it's intellectual or private, there is no problem. And then you move on to this bizarre situation. It's like, well, as long as seed gets it, then it's going to get out everywhere. That's your theory. Okay? So that doesn't happen until a contract is broken. And then you assume it becomes super abundant, although I really won't even give you that. But that's your argument. It's a disgrace. It's a disaster.
I think it's a good time to end. Konkin had this figured out years ago. Konkin saw the nightmare world that your Gallimbosian kind of spoonerist, insane IP idea.
It's not Gallimbosian. I mean, Stefan, you're throwing Gallimbosian's theory is not my theory. He had no theory with regard to independent discovery. Don't you even understand Gallimbos?
Well, Gallimbos' theory.
Laugh again because you're wrong again.
Every time you're wrong, you laugh.
So it's a real tell. You must be a bad poker player.
Spooner and Gallimbos.
Your tell is so obvious.
They both believe
in it. Your tell is so obvious.
No, they believe
in it. Anybody out there, with Goodfellas laughing, he's caught in another one by the balls. Gallimbos has no room in his theory for independent discovery. I am not Gallimbosian at all. It's another distortion of yours. Either that or you don't understand
Gallimbos. So you're Gallimbosian, you don't understand, plus the independent discovery exception. So you're like Gallimbos prime. Okay, fine. But you both believe in a very open-ended definition of IP.
Hold it. I lost. Where did you see this Gallimbosian independent discovery? Where did you see that, Stefan? You throw more shit out. Where did you see that? Tell me where you see that.
Like
where I can look that up.
I said you're saying you're like Gallimbos with one exception, with one difference.
Congratulations. I didn't say I was like Gallimbos with one exception. Don't distort. I said I am not Gallimbosian, and the most clear point where I'm not Gallimbosian is with regard to independent discovery. Gallimbosian does not have that in his view.
You both believe in a wide array of IP rights that would last in perpetuity. So did Spooner, I believe. So.
But that doesn't go to the main point that you're just distorting.
That is the main point.
Distorting my view with Gallimbosian. No, it's not.
Yeah,
I think
your ideas are as insane as Gallimbos's and Spooner's. I think they would lead to the death of all humankind, honestly, if they were really followed. But of course, people.
Hold it. You think copyright and patent would lead to the death of mankind?
Yeah. I think if you enforced it strictly.
You think copyright and patent would lead to the death of mankind?
I think your IP ideas enforced broadly.
No. How my ideas, which are less strict than current patent ideas.
No, they're not. No, they're not. Yours lasts in perpetuity.
Yeah, but what does that have to do with
That means that you couldn't use a goddamn wheel right now, dude.
Death of mankind?
You couldn't build a log cabin. You couldn't
devise. How is it going to lead to the death of mankind?
Because you'd have to get permission from everyone on the earth to do anything. You couldn't cook
food. No, what did you have independent discovery?
You can't have independent discovery once the invention is publicly known.
If it's publicly known, it's in the public. That is super abundant.
Oh, now you have a public domain exception too? I mean, I can't tell what you're in favor.
No, we're using the English language, aren't we? Are we not?
One of us is.
Does anybody have the patent on the English language? That is super.
Why
abundant.
Not? Why shouldn't someone have the patent on it, or on the Constitution for that matter? I mean, what about Austrian economics? How dare you use ideas you haven't paid for?
What are you talking about?
I mean, you're using Austrian economics ideas in your reasoning.
You learned that
from someone else.
Hold it. Let's get back to the English language.
In fact,
okay?
You made money off your blog, right?
See, that's Gallimbosian, okay? Gallimbosian says every word is invented and you can't use it in the future, okay? There is no question that there are words, ideas, and things out there in the public domain, okay? There is no question.
Like what?
But that is, well, like the English language, air.
Why is it super abundant.
That's why we're not even discussing topics like that.
So are you telling me that if you reveal your house building technique to a dozen people by contract,
for
somehow one of them nefariously leaks it onto WikiLeaks in an encrypted file, you don't know which one of them did it, but soon there's copies of this, billions of copies and computers all over the world. At that point in time, are you saying that all the people in the world are free to use the information because now it's super abundant and now it's a public good? Is that what you're saying? Or a public domain?
See again, that's my point. Your whole framework and I'm telling you.
Well, what's the answer?
I'm about to explain that to you, okay? Your whole framework is built upon broken contract.
Well, what's the answer
Without
to the
broken
question?
Contract,
Once the information becomes public, can people use it or not?
Let me continue. Without a broken contract, you have no theory. Okay,
no.
Your theory doesn't apply until somehow.
That's not true.
Becomes broken in a super abundant manner.
Okay, but first of all, that's not
so.
The other argument is that your contract idea is ridiculous. No one would agree to this contract in the first place. The entire idea is totally.
No one would agree to what contract?
To keep the information secret and never use it.
And never use it? Who said something about not using the information? What are you talking about?
Your contract is going to limit what they can do with the information they learn from you.
Yeah, it happens all the time.
Yeah, it happens because there's copyright. People can be bullied into this kind of crap.
No. How about Watergate hipsters? There are people that gave information to Woodward and Bernstein.
Yeah, and now it's out.
For all kinds of different... Yeah. So the point is, So
it's public.
What?
It's public. It gets out.
Yeah, but at the point where somebody has the information, okay, uh-huh. It's private information, and there may have been many, many reporters trying to get at it. There's another kind of rivalry. And people rivalry? Try to dig up,
sure
pick
have
up the information.
A flexible use of the word rivalry. Competitors are rivals.
Well, if you got a reporter,
if I want your girlfriend,
yeah,
that's a rival. We're both rivals for the same girl. I guess if I steal your girlfriend, I violated your property right.
Yeah,
I mean,
you go into the smart ass mode again.
Yeah,
if
because you
won't
be clear.
There,
never,
if
I gave you in the beginning, I told you to define your terms. You won't do it.
There's rivalry between different news information, news sources,
yeah, they're competitors.
Organizations yeah. to get information.
Yeah.
It's a rivalry. It is searching for scarce information.
Yeah, so we need property rights to stop this rivalry. It's horrible. We don't want people rivaling against each other.
No, there is no right. There's no problem there with people trying to attempt to search out information. You're totally distorting the situation.
So,
okay? Still,
you didn't answer the question. Can people use the information about your house building technique once it becomes public?
Here's the way this works, okay? you're creating a straw man.
Man. This is how the world works, dude. Look at WikiLeaks right now. You can find the formula for Coca-Cola right now. It's online.
Let me explain it to you, okay? First of all,
just a simple yes.
Your
no.
framework doesn't work until a contract is broken.
That's not true.
Okay.
Maybe a contract.
Maybe a contract
won't be entered.
Why are you always bringing up these situations where the contract is broken?
Because you're the one who's building your whole theory on contract, and I'm showing that it won't work. You can't bind third parties with your contract.
If I have a contract, okay, if I have something that I consider extremely, extremely valuable, I am not going to release that to anyone unless I construct a contract where the person that releases it is not prevented or does not have to pay a severe penalty if he releases it to an outside party.
This is why,
okay?
I think that the contracts are not feasible. People are not going to agree to pay severe penalties as a
regular.
Why not?
They do that all the time.
They do.
What's
it because
a
there's a threat of copyright
agreement?
Anyway. It doesn't add anything extra, but without copyright, people... Look, imagine I'm J.K. Rowling and I have the next Harry Potter book, okay? And I'm selling a copy on Amazon for $15, whatever. And I say, if you buy this book, you have to agree that if you ever make a copy of it or ever loan it to a friend, then I can sue you for $1 million. Okay? Now, what right. idiot is going to buy the book and be willing to
exactly.
pay?
Exactly. Exactly.
No
this
one, Bob. No
now.
One will sign these stupid
exactly.
contracts.
Exactly. Exactly, Stefan. So the contract wouldn't be written that way. You're creating
right.
another straw
they
man.
They won't be written. Your contracts
you create,
are not realistic.
You create absurd straw man.
It's not absurd,
no one
Bob.
Is gonna,
it's
the
not
contract,
absurd.
The contract is not going to be designed that way, Stefan.
But how's it
totally
wait. How's it going to be designed then?
Who knows? Let the free market decide.
So in other words, you
why
think
you
maybe
decide?
You could have contracts that could have something like IP, but what would the contracts look like? Who knows? What would IP look like? Who knows?
Stefan,
I'm still in favor of it.
Stefan, that's how the free market works.
So
you know?
If what you're saying
don't,
is whatever contract people come up with
don't,
to safeguard look,
now,
information.
Now you're attacking the way free market works. The free market allows anybody to design any contract, any kind of way they want. Are you against that?
You're so bad.
Are you against that, Stefan?
You're such an idiot, dude. Can you seriously believe
yeah,
this
right.
stuff?
Look, you don't understand Rothbard. You make terrible accusations against utilitarians when you don't even understand the paper they've written.
Are you utilitarian now? I thought you didn't like utilitarians either.
I told you I'm not a utilitarian, that the only problem I have is the way you attack those guys and you didn't
problem,
understand
unquote.
The paper. You're all over the place. You don't understand this stuff. You create absurd...
let someone listen
to
this
here we go with the laugh.
I'm
here
all
we
over
go
the
with
place.
The laugh again.
Because you're
what,
insane. I think you really have
you
a mental
time?
Problem. I mean, you're insane. You really are insane. Do you really live in this dream world or are you just trying to get... It's just for sensationalism.
A dream. Hold, let me get this straight. Okay. I have a formula for drudge, which
oh, for
I
God
think
sake.
Is scarce, and you somehow think it's super abundant.
I think it's actually.
And
I
live
I think
in
it's
a dream world.
Made up in your own mind.
What?
I don't think you're even. Do you have a formula for drudge?
Well, hey, I could. We can ask Chris Rossini, the producer of the show, because he knows part of it. I have a formula, but
uh-huh.
okay. So you're laughing again, and again you're wrong. Stefan.
Buy nickels. Hey, buy nickels, Bob.
What's that?
Buy nickels. You gave away that information for free. Buy nickels. Another formula. You got all these formulas.
I don't even know what your point is there. That's just totally bizarre, Stefan. Along with your worm, clown, weasel comments, your predictions are terrible, that I wasn't going to be here, that I wasn't eager to expose you with all this stuff.
Stefan Kinsella was wrong about Wenzel debating, so their IP must be justified.
No, the point is that you create things in your mind that just aren't really the case from whether I would debate you. And certainly we're going on over 2 hours now.
Yeah.
So
it's time to wrap it up.
You're wrong about that. So you're wrong about that. You're not a clear thinker. Your book, and I've only gone through about four things, unfortunately, of the many, many sloppy things you have in the book. It's a terrible book. Terrible book. And you're just wrong. You don't understand Rothbard. And you don't understand scarcity.
I don't understand IP either. I don't know IP either.
You have a foggy
or
confused.
HAPA. I don't know HAPA or Mises that well. Praxeology, Rothbard, contract theory. Yeah, yeah. I don't know that you know. You should have a property right in your girlfriend and be protected from competition. And I don't know that it's crazy to think that someone would agree to pay $1 million damages for using information they paid for. Yeah.
See, again, you're creating straw men. You create these straw men as to how a contract would occur, how it would be enforced, to what degree it would be enforced, and what would happen if the contract is broken. You get to the bizarre point that a contract will be broken and then become super abundant. May not be the case at all.
So I think we need to wrap it up. Let me just add a couple concluding remarks. You can say whatever you like, but I will say that congratulations in a way, because we're living partly in the world that you want, the nightmare world where literally hundreds of billions of dollars are wasted on patent lawsuits and innovation, intimidation tactics, extortion, literal extortion. Oligopolies are created. Competition is reduced. Innovation is distorted and reduced. The government's using copyright to censor, to threaten, to ratchet up the police state and to control the internet. People are going to jail for downloading copies of movies. So congratulations, you've kind of got part of the world that your nightmare scenario vision of IP would lead to, a completely fascist, anti-property rights world, and I hope to God we will never get it extended any farther than it is. But congratulations, you've kind of got part of what you want with the modern copyright and IP system. But thank God real libertarians and Austrians almost universally recognize the horrible fascist police state, anti-competitive, anti-human life thing that IP is, and are moving against it. And maybe someday that'll help influence the policy and keep it from getting any worse. No thanks to the efforts of people like you to muddy the waters and to justify the police state actions we have now.
Well, Stefan, it's really interesting. You can't even keep your argument straight from the beginning of your opening remarks to the end here, because what you've done is you've attacked me by as being totalitarian fascist. Clearly things that you stated in the opening remarks that you didn't want to have, you didn't want me to say. Okay. Secondly, you've got a distortion with regard to putting me in the same camp as current government views. Again, that is not the case. My case is the Rothbardian case. It is not the current government method in which copyright and patent is used. For Rothbard, it's copyright, perpetual copyright. It is copyright that allows for independent discovery. And the same thing with patent. It's perpetual patent that allows for independent discovery. There is no government that instills laws or penalties. It's all done by private contract, so no one would buy a record where the penalty would be many, many years in jail if they share that with someone somehow against the desires of the music industry. So again, it's another distortion of how the you're attempting to view the Rothbardian method, which you don't understand because you clearly don't understand the book.
Okay.
I rest my case.
All right. Well, thanks, Bob.
Thank you.